You're about to listen to TADPOG. Tyler and Dave play old games. It's a comedy video game podcast. We would like to stress that the hosts are not experts and are really just very crass commentators. Seriously, this is an explicit podcast that happens to talk about video games sometimes. So please enjoy this pretty okay podcast with Tyler and Dave.
Hello, Internet, and welcome to another TADPOG podcast.
I hope that my sigh from saying let's record a podcast about Pac-Man 2 bleeds into the beginning, yeah. Pac-Man 2.
To perfectly encapsulate this game in a...
Yeah, that's the quote from this episode. Pac-Man 2.
Tell them, Dave, play old games. We're just a little old podcast.
Homegrown.
Homegrown, artisanal, grassroots.
Grateful Dead cover band.
Backwoods. Yeah.
Wouldn't that be great? I'd tune into that, like a Grateful Dead cover band that also does a retro video game podcast.
Okay, all right.
I mean, I'd listen to at least one.
Yeah, you're right. But I said Grateful Dead, I could not name a single song by the Grateful Dead.
Scarlet Begonias. And that's
okay,
probably...
I'll try to remember that.
That's probably the only one. It's because Sublime covered it. There's also ones that I could, like, if I heard them, I would be like, that's a Grateful Dead song. But I can't, like, name it.
The only thing I know about the Grateful Dead are Jerry Bears. Because
yeah.
I had, in high school, I had an art class with a girl who every single project, that's what she did in some way, incorporated them into the project, made just them, whatever. That's the only thing she ever did.
And when was this?
2000.
So it was high school then?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, yeah.
You know she fucked.
Oh, yeah. Oh, no. Prolifically. No, this girl is the epitome.
No, I don't even know her. I could tell you that she definitely did.
Uh-huh. Oh, no. No, she did. She definitely did.
If you're in high school drawing Jerry Bears for every project, you're definitely fucking.
Unless
you're a guy, in which
case
you might
not be. And has an STD. So, yeah, absolutely. Absolutely.
And so not only does she fuck, she likes to feel it.
Yep.
All right. Okay.
She was also my girlfriend in the fourth grade.
Hey, yo. Yeah. Was she bigger than the Grateful Dead at that point?
Probably.
Yeah. All right. But we're not here to talk about the Grateful Dead.
No, surprisingly not.
We're not here. We're not.
We are here to talk about fourth grade girlfriends who later became sluts.
Not that there's anything wrong with that.
Nope.
I'm a huge fan.
You do you. Yeah. We're not going to yuck anyone's yum, especially if it's sluts.
Especially mine, because I'm into that. But we're not here to, you mean we're not here to like randomly go through track by track of the Grateful Dead's discography and then talk about it here on this show?
Not yet.
Is that what this spins off into?
Eventually, probably.
We're going to randomize the Grateful Dead's contribution to society.
After like that one dude who had a railroad spike go through his head and it changed his personality, when that happens to me and I then love all forms of music, that's what it can spin off into.
I don't know that I want to do it. Because it's like, I'm the worst and people are going to not like this. But you know what? It's me, baby.
I think you're the best, Dave. You're not the worst.
Grateful Dead, not a huge fan, but I know a lot of people are.
Mm-hmm.
I am a fish boy, though.
Mm-hmm.
I do love some fish, but only the good stuff from the 80s and the 90s.
You like the bad stuff?
Yeah. I
love their bad stuff.
Oh, their bad stuff.
I'm a Jacob York contrarian. I exclusively only listen to their bad stuff.
No, it's one of those where it's like, I haven't listened to any of their new things, so I have no idea if they're... I still like them.
Anything made around the time of the ice cream when that first came out, that's the good fish stuff.
Actually, it's a little bit before that.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. I mean, when the ice cream came out, it was still like,
That's all I know about fish is fish food.
Fish food is the best Ben & Jerry's.
Yep.
It's the best.
I'm with you.
It's the best Ben & Jerry's.
The best that is available, yes.
Oh, okay. Well, wait.
Oatmeal Cookie Chunk, I think, is the best Ben and Jerry's.
That doesn't even have a funny name or a band tie-in.
That's how good it is.
Fuck
it,
that.
It doesn't need it.
No,
that's how good it is.
I need it. I need it.
Could have been Oatmeal Cookie Monster, but still, like.
Now I'm in. Now I understand that you, Ben and Jerry's, are a legitimate ice cream company. Who's reaching out to.
I need you to buy up Weird Al and really lean into the name.
Yes. Oh, man. Yeah, really. They really are kind of chomping on Weird Al's bit there with the ice cream names.
A little bit.
But we're not here to talk about Grateful Dead or Ben and Jerry's.
Or fish.
For now. We'll bring up some stuff.
But we are here to talk about how we're playing every single Super Nintendo game. And to give it some flavor, we're doing it randomly. So like the Israelites did, we are building our own false god to worship to help us get through it.
Well, that's the only way.
So our version of Baal, the golden calf god, the randomizer.
Movie cow.
The randomizer is a just beautiful spreadsheet that Dave uses to randomly generate a number that will correlate with Super Nintendo games, and whatever that one is, we do it.
And the number this time was, I don't know, but it corresponded to Pac-Man 2, colon, The New Adventures.
Heck yeah. Oh, man. Okay, but before that, I'm your beard host, Tyler. I see we got a package over there.
We do. We have a package. This is actually a continuation of the last package that we opened from Kira and Bunny.
Coffee?
They sent us coffee last time. And then
you're drinking that coffee.
I am. Was I supposed to wait?
No, I just remembered. Oh, you're drinking that coffee. We could talk about that.
I am. I just started drinking it because I was like, man, you remember last episode? I was like, okay, what I need to do for every recording is stay up super late and then drink a whole bunch of coffee before we start. It's a tradition now. This is the second time. So
and you feel good doing it.
I do feel good doing it. But here's what I'm worried about. A year from now, I'm going to be like, fuck, can I do a podcast without staying up late and drinking coffee? Am I using it as a crutch? Do I need to like do cocaine?
Yeah, do I need like a little bit of meth and just go ahead and stay up all the next day?
The cat's gonna have a little meth.
How much meth can Dave's have? A little bit. Just a little bit. Elizabeth Warren says Dave's gonna have no meth. Bernie Sanders,
Dave's gonna have a little meth. Audio memes, they're back. In audio form.
It's not part of our opioid crisis. I say Dave has a little meth.
That's a pretty good Bernie. What? It's great because I know you've practiced doing Larry David for years. And all you have to do is just alter it an octave.
Yep.
and slow it down a little bit. You're done. That's very good. I'm impressed. I mean, not to say that all your impressions aren't just the best, but that one's really good.
Oh, yeah. It's an okay man.
Ooga?
Yeah.
So this is a continuation of the package that we opened last week, which did include the Death Wish coffee and also
Valhalla Java Odin Force blend.
That is a long name. Mm-hmm. I'm drinking it now. I got to be honest, this tastes better than the Death Wish coffee.
Yeah, I don't think it's as potent, but I do like the taste of it more. So you have the hot variety in that Yeti cup, and in that Spider-Man cup, the cold brew version that I made.
Which... You know I don't like cold brew, but I was like, I definitely want to give this a try, and I want to give it a try on the show. So just to confirm, I've been drinking the hot coffee. Mm-hmm. I do like it.
So I took 4 cups of the ground Valhalla Java.
It smells so bad.
And steeped it in 16 cups of cold water for 10 hours, strained it this morning into a giant-ass pitcher. And I had some this morning, and I was pleased with it.
Are you familiar with Ordinary People memes?
No.
It's an Instagram account, and Chris Black of Carnov fame is a huge fan, and he shares them with me occasionally. I don't have Instagram, but I'm thinking about getting it because it's like, man, there are a lot of content creators on Reddit who have Instagram. I think I might need to check into that.
Yeah.
But he shares these Ordinary People memes with me, and they're all great. It's essentially just like photographs of like, people that you would expect to see like on like the inside of a brochure for like an industrial flooring company or something like that. Like, I'm the president, Bob Flooring. And it's like, so just imagine Bob Flooring in your mind. Mm-hmm. And then the meme part of it, the text part of it would essentially be like, I'm going to call Verizon and take care of this in the morning. And it usually just matches up. Like, you read it, and then you look at their face and their expression, and you're like, yeah, nailed it.
That's like stock photos you put over what a normal person would say.
Right,
okay.
Exactly. Okay. So he showed me one the other day, and I was like, fuck, man, that one got me, because it's essentially, it's a person who did not look like me, but I guess maybe alternate Dave is absolutely a female nurse in scrubs with a, let me talk to your manager, Karen haircut.
Oh, perfect. Uh-huh.
And it says, all it says is, I don't like cold brew coffee. I like my coffee hot is what it says. That's what it says. I like my coffee hot. And I read it and I was like, well, yeah, I'm with that. So anyway, that's a long way of saying that I don't like any cold brew that I've ever had.
It's fair. You probably won't like that one.
I probably won't, but I want to try it. So also don't be offended if I don't it.
When you immediately spit it out and curse my name, I won't be offended.
I have a soundboard in front of me, so I won't spit it out. It smells so bad though. There's more caffeine in cold.
It might just be the inside of that cup.
Oh shit! Is this a cum cup? Spider-Man, I'm almost there.
They're all cum cups, if I'm honest.
Any cup can be a cum cup. All right, I'm doing it. Yeah, here, you can have the rest of that. You don't want?
I've got all my downers. Thank you very much.
Oh yeah.
I've got my Goldschlager and apple juice. You've got all your uppers, and I've got all my downers.
Shit, we're like the motherfucking yin and yang up in here. Uppers and downers?
Yeah, law and chaos.
Fuck, man. Why aren't we doing a Grateful Dead podcast?
I don't know. Or a Dungeons and Dragons podcast. Or a Opposites Attract.
All right, new idea for a podcast. It's just called Opposites. And what we do is we sit down and just list things that are opposites.
Love it.
What we do, it's super dirty, so the only kids who are interested in listening to it can't. Well, but they really want to. Like, yeah, these are the guys.
They'll do it
about
secretly.
These are the guys talking about cum cups.
This is the Sesame Street dark web.
I don't know that I want to go to Sesame Street dark web. But all of that cold brew tasting ushers in a segment that we like to call Kira and Bunny Send Us More Stuff. And by that, I mean, I forgot to bring these last time.
Oh, no, shit.
And forgot
good.
They existed.
All good.
And then Kira sent me a message and said, hey, did you get that other thing? And I was like, oh, yeah, that's from you too, huh? Okay. What I have here are mugs.
Oh, fuck yes.
Our mugs. That has, here's one that has the Tadpog logo on it. And on the back, it says Davy Poo, Master of Spectacles.
Okay, so that's mine.
So that's yours. Mine, on the other hand.
The other guy.
That's for Josh. You don't get one. I'm sorry. It has our logo on it. And then, here, I'll throw it. I'll throw this ceramic mug. I'll toss it to you. Let me zip line it to you, Pac-Man 2 style.
Thank you. Ty Lore, TY-LOR. The majestically bearded one. That's so very sweet and awesome. Thank you.
Thank you, Kira and Bunny. You guys are fucking awesome. I got to see them on Twitch chat the other day, and it was really nice. I like seeing those guys.
Because I keep the other mug I have, the Tadpog one with the Etch-A-Sketch. When you pour hot water into it, it turns into the Etch-A-Sketch, Tyler and Dave. That one I can keep at work. That way it's like I have my Tadpog thing right here. And not everyone will know I do a podcast. They can go hear their boss listen. So it's good.
Ah, I see. So you're like in it. Because I'm worried about Henry getting older and listening to the show. But you're like actively like shit.
Actively like, I'm careful about who I tell I do a podcast to at work.
I used to be, which is weird. Because I used to be like really like, I don't know. I certainly had podcasting shame.
Mm-hmm.
I don't like go around bragging about it anymore, but it's very much like if someone finds this, they find it. It's kind of the point, right? Mm-hmm. So,
because my boss listens and I've asked her, like, you think this will affect me going forward? And she's like, no, I think you're totally fine.
That's good.
I'm like, all right, well, I'll trust that.
All right. That's all you can do.
Probably shouldn't advertise it. Like, I'm not going to wear the Tadpog shirt to work, but
When someone asks for a raise, you're like, what's our theme song?
perfect.
And then at the end of the meeting, you say, how would you like to close this out?
No raise.
No raise decline. Just stamp. But I see you drew a lot of Jerry Bears on your raise application form.
So, nickel. There you go. I did just get done giving out raises, which was nice because we've got...
Can I have one,
I got
please?
More to give out this year than I ever have before, so that was nice.
That is good. Yeah, that is good. That must, you're like fucking Santa Claus. That's nice. I like
mm-hmm.
that. You've been, what you've been, that's been your week? You been up to anything?
Jack's been sick.
That sucks. He didn't look super sick.
He's much better now, that's but good. He was a snotty boy.
Oh.
Very snotty boy.
Were you worried that it was going to have to be like hospital time?
A little bit,
yeah.
But we took him in and he came back negative for all the bad stuff. So it's like, okay, that's as long as it's not RSV, flu,
or
starting that ear infection domino, we're good.
Yeah, fucking flu, terrifying.
Yeah, Kenna had it 2 weeks ago. She had flu A,
yikes,
of all things. So, although I still have that rich font that Phil sent us, if you want to, we want to fill up some airtime with something funny before we roll into our sad fest.
Wait, do we do funny things here? Is this a new thing we're going
to
try out?
Well, it's funny to us. I don't know if it's funny to anybody else.
That's all that matters. Clementine tried to steal my power this week.
I meant to ask, did your glasses also get eaten?
They got eaten.
Oh.
I almost wore contacts over here just to fuck with the show.
I've seen you in contacts enough time that I probably wouldn't say anything.
How long ago has that been, though?
I mean, it's been a minute.
It's been probably since college. I think it's the last time I wore them.
Oh, really?
No, that's not true. I wore for a little bit in Lexington. Yeah, man. She got my... I fell asleep on the couch, and she got my glasses and chewed the fuck out of it. You can see the bone of my frames there, which is essentially just a safety pin-looking thing sticking out. So I got to do the fun thing of, like... All right.
Beating a dog's ass.
Well, we're not going to get into that. Because Nikki was like, oh, this would be a fun story for you to tell. And I was like, I'll leave out the part where I almost murdered our dog. but no, it was like...
Because my mom told me about it.
Yeah, I was pretty... well, that makes me feel real bad then.
Did you hear about Dave's dog? What? It ate his glasses. I have not heard that.
And it ceases to exist. No, she's fine. We made our peace at lunch. And once I realized, it's like, okay, fine. I can still wear these. They're just incredibly uncomfortable. So I went through the whole process of like, I got to call the people I got the glasses from. And then we do that. And then it's like, oh, you haven't had your eyes checked in 3 years, so we can't craft you lenses without a prescription. And it's like, it's fine. I see fine. Everything's cool.
Can you take these out and put them in new glasses?
Well, see, she also got the lenses a little bit too, like down at the bottom. Like, she really...
Oh, fuck.
Like, these are okay. I can see. It's fine. It's
what
just,
about it is appealing to chew on? Even as a dog, I don't understand.
Maybe like the ear stank at the... Because that's where she got it, really. It was like the ear stank. Mm. She also chews on everything. Like, she is... I've only really owned 3 dogs, but like, she is the worst one about chewing on shit. Like, she constantly will get, she'll go in, like if Henry leaves his door open, she'll go in.
Chew on Henry.
Yes. She'll go in.
He screams so loud.
He's got he only has 8 fingers left.
He runs on his ankles like a Wendigo.
That's why I call him my little Wendigo. Look at my little wiener go.
Henry, time to go to school.
What really sucks is he's really pigeonholed when we play X-Men. He can really only play one character, and that is the Wendigo. I'm usually Sabretooth. I don't know why we're all villains.
We're playing good X-Men.
Yeah, right. Yeah, we go and terrorize the town. We're bad X-Men! We kick people's shopping carts.
Are those even X-Men if they're the villains?
We're bad ones!
Wouldn't they be the Brotherhood? Are they the Brotherhood of Evil Mutants? Or are they the bad X-Men? Is it like the DC's Bizarro World?
Well, the Brotherhood is essentially bad X-Men, if you think about it.
Colossus was in there for a little while.
Also, why's it got to be a Brotherhood? Vanish.
There's the Brotherhood of Evil Mutants and the Sisterhood of Traveling Pants. That's how it goes.
Not to brag, but I have issue 1 of the Sisterhood of Traveling Pants in near mint condition.
Signed by Alexis Bledel.
it's been graded and everything. So I got to go get my eyes checked, and I do that thing, And then, you know, you sit down and you've had your eyes checked because you have glasses, you know. You sit down in that thing and they put the giant like Wally binoculars over you. Mm-hmm. And then they're like, this or this, this or this. And it got to the point where I was like, all right, did you make a change? Because it's like, I really, and he's like, that's good. That's good. That means that we're close. And it's like, okay, great. And then he's like, okay, we're done. Your lens prescription has not changed. And he's like, that'll be $85. And it's like, all right, here you go, I guess. So I got my little prescription, go over to the eyeglass store.
Just help me. I'm proud to be an American.
And I got in and I'm like, okay, we called earlier. My dog chewed up my glasses. Apparently that happens a lot because the woman was like, yeah, we see that. And, you know, we always tell people, put those glasses up high.
Acts of dog are not covered by your insurance policy.
Oh, don't worry. I don't have vision. I don't know who you think I am. I just got health insurance back January. Mm. No vision. You think I would, because it is a lot of money that I pay.
Yeah.
A lot. But I don't. Whatever, it's fine. It's no big deal. It's just like, my health insurance policy is like,
I could have gotten divorced and we could have gotten married so you'd be on my vision plan, Dave. Then got your glasses, then got another divorce again, and then remarried Melissa.
Fuck, why weren't we thinking?
Been fine.
We can't get married in Kentucky.
Oh, can we not?
There'll be a big stink about it and it'll go viral.
Oh, but then we can, like, then they can say hosts of the TADPOG podcast were refused for their gay marriage license.
Shit, that's brilliant marketing. I love it. All right, fuck it. Let's get married. She's like, put the glasses up higher next time. And it's like, thanks, I've had these for like 3 years, and this is like the only time this has happened, but whatever. And then she's also like, well, look at our glasses. And I'm like, all right, I've taken 2 seconds, looked at them. I just want these glasses that I'm wearing. Mm-hmm. Like, can you get these? And she's like, let me check. She goes to the computer. She's like, we can get them. They are on back order. It could take a month. And it's like, fine. I don't have to. What you're telling me is, I don't have to worry about this for a month. I can just wear these broken-ass glasses, but in the back of my mind, it's like, this will be taken care of. I'm done here.
Yeah, there you go. All right.
80% of my work life is like looking at bars filling up. That's essentially what's going on here. It just takes a month for that bar to fill up.
So you should wait your limit break. I get it.
Yeah, oh, yeah. Man. Whew.
That sucks so fucking bad, though.
I mean, it's
badly.
It's not the end of the world. It's all taken care of. That bar's filling up. 3 weeks, that bar's going to be full.
But see, reading more from What Innocent Search Turned Out to Be Porn. As a mechanical engineer working in an offshore company, I needed an example of a spreader bar. Google did not work very well.
Now, these are from Ask Reddit.
These are from Ask Reddit.
These are search terms
that you
innocuous.
Typed in innocently,
yeah.
And it turned out to be porn.
Okay.
When I was about 10 and playing Morrowind for the first time, I wanted to see, did I do this one? What high-level armor,
I
Googled ebony.
Oh, yeah. Really? This tells you a lot about my search terms, I guess, but it's like that, the first thing that comes up is porn. I would think it'd be like the magazine or something.
Yeah. Or if somebody said like ebony, I'd be like the ingot?
Yeah.
So.
Well, I don't know, like, maybe they just searched it in Pornhub.
Yeah, you'd think the magazine would come up first. I remember this one. Back in the wild west of the net, anyone who used .com instead of .gov when going to the White House's website, I did that to a girl in high school.
Yes.
Found up porn. She flipped out, told on me.
Not a Jerry Bear drawer.
No. But she did later get addicted to cocaine.
All right. So there we go.
Yeah.
You know, you probably did that to her. Did you ever think about that?
Probably.
Probably would be it.
She keeps flashbacks of whitehouse.com.
That's how she gets rid of it, through the cocaine. Every time she thinks about it, she's like, ah, oh, gotta get it. Gotta bump a grind.
Man, I need to bump my grind. My retired dad thought he would do some substitute teaching. Classroom management was a problem, and he had no idea how to deal with unruly students. So on the school computer, hit Google up for some ideas on teen discipline.
Oh, boy. I don't know how you fucking search for anything. Like, you can never, like, look. You can, like, never go to the internet for, like, stepdad help. Because yep. I'm telling you, I don't seek it out, but I still see a lot of it. Like, I mean, it's very much like on the, like, it's at the very front.
15 years ago in class, I was looking for roosters, so I Googled male chicks, got pictures of guys in their underwear.
All right.
When I was a dumb kid in the mid-90s, the computer clock was wrong in my computer classroom. The World Wide Web, as everyone seemed to call it at the time, was very new to me, but I knew I could find this stuff out. What website would this be on? My dumb little fuck British brain decided to go to BigBen.com. My first introduction to the gay porn was around 8 years old. All right, that makes sense for gay porn. Big Ben, okay.
I'm going to pull it up right now. I'm going to see if it's still, I'm going to see if it still exists.
So you'd want to go to Big Ben. He makes sure he clarifies. So BigBen.co.uk.
Well, I'm going to BigBen.com first. I'm going to see what's there. That takes me to Royal.
I need my Big Ben's American. Thank you very much.
Is that, wouldn't that be weird? Like, can you imagine, like, to me, that's insane. Where it's like, what do you mean you don't type in .com at the end? You know what I mean?
Like, I still do it.
So, yeah, for the record, BigBen.com takes you to RoyalShave.com. But Big Ben dot, what is it, co.uk?
Ross, tell us more about this Big Ben.
Yeah.
Who is Big Ben and how big is Ben?
Look, kids, Big Ben.
Ross, are you Big Ben? I've seen your third ball.
Is it BigBen.co.uk?
Uh-huh. Nothing.
Not anymore. No
Fuck.
Longer.
And BigBen.com doesn't yield anything?
It takes me to Royal Shave.
Oh, man. Damn, we'll never know how Big Ben was.
We're going to have to find our gay porn
Fuck.
Somewhere else.
Who was Big Ben, the British boy in the mid-90s? We have to know.
Hey, Siri. Who was Big Ben, the British boy in the mid-90s? She doesn't know.
One time in high school, my teacher was using her laptop via projector. We got an off-topic talking about her pregnancy. Yada yada, she Googled black booties.
Yada yada yada,
in baby
she
shoes.
Blew us all.
Yada yada yada, she got pregnant.
What did she search for? Booties?
Black booties. Like baby shoes.
Okay. That seems like a weird, like, you know, that was a very long conversation, you know, to like get to the point.
I hope someone led her there hoping she would do that.
Yeah.
Do you, I mean, I love baby shoes. I do too. I guess I should look into those. Black ones look very cute.
Have
okay.
you seen those black booties?
Black baby shoes? They call them booties. Okay. Black booties.
Pull it up.
I've got three for you. One, I typed in scat looking for jazz singing, not knowing what that also means. Melissa says that when she sneezes because her granny always said it.
She says scat?
Scat. When she sneezes, she goes, scat.
Really?
And where I went, why do you say that? Because my granny always did.
Now?
You know, it means shit. And she looked at me like I blew her mind. She's like, are you serious? Yeah, that was her Christian way of saying shit.
Scat? Now? In front of everybody?
All right. Two, I looked up grandpa piss, trying to find screenshots from a Monster Factory video. That one's on you, bro.
Yeah.
Not me, but my dad used to order golf balls online from Dick's at Work before they opened one in Oklahoma City. He typed in Dick Sports. That was greeted by a gay porn site.
So wait, you know what that whole post was? Is they were just throwing that middle one out there to be like, it's okay to like grandpa piss.
Grandpa
right?
piss is like,
It was a Monster Factory thing.
So apparently that's a thing, because the follow-up comment to that is, you got to be real careful trying to find Monster Factory stuff. McElroy family content has a way of being, shall we say, easily mistakable for other content.
I think that's the secret.
So what is Monster Factory then? Because I'm familiar with McElroy Monster
you
Family.
Know. No, that's what it is. It's Monster Factory. It's Griffin and Justin building characters in like
yeah.
a video game. That's
Which
what it
is. Which I think is a fucking brilliant idea.
And then they name them, and they must have named one Grandpa Piss.
Grandpa Piss. Oh.
It's my guess.
Okay,
I don't know. I haven't seen all of them.
That makes an infinite amount of sense to me.
But see, that's their brilliance, is like that person in that comment summed up the brilliance of that, where it's like, it is... It's like that Patton Oswalt bit where you got goof juice in my hoo-ha, you know?
Oh, yeah.
Where it's like it's something very dirty, but you
gotta clean
present
it, up.
It in an innocuous way, yeah. and it's like all of a sudden, yeah, it's funny.
Mm-hmm. Although you should probably Google more than just grandpa piss. Like Monster Factory, grandpa piss.
Yeah. Yeah, yeah, no. Yeah. No, that was... I feel like that is somebody who definitely wanted to see Grandpa Piss.
Like, and then
yeah.
like, no, I'm looking for McElroy content.
No, Monster Factory. Oops, I just did Grandpa Piss Monster.
Monster Grandpa Piss.
Grandpa's Monster Piss. You seen the new energy drink? Monster Grandpa Piss.
You see TADPOG's new shirt, Grandpa's Monster Piss? It's all about Casey's huge urethra.
TADPOG's out of the shirt business. I hope you guys, if you wanted a shirt, I hope you bought one at shirts.tadpog.com because they don't exist anymore.
Oh, damn. All right.
It's a lie. I'm just trying to drive. That's called driving sales.
But it's about, it'll be, we're doing our going out of business sale.
Yeah, right. Yeah. That's it, like the furniture stores always do that where it's like, we're going out of business. And then they never do it. And
we're just opening now. Grand opening. Right? Going out of business.
Yeah. That's how we do with our shirts.
Because I can't see myself buying brand new cars or brand new furniture.
I think every bit of furniture I've ever owned, except for a table, has been like...
Because you can find perfectly good shit on Marketplace, man, like secondhand furniture.
Yeah, absolutely. I've owned a new car. I owned a brand new car and I drove it for a very long time. Yeah. But
was the Celica new when you got it?
No, fuck no. Mm. But the Grand Am was.
Oh, okay.
And that was like, the only reason I got it new is because it's like, it was last year's model, but it had never been driven. Mm-hmm. And it had rolled down windows, crank windows, and it was the base package. And it had, because it was last year's model, they had like a rebate on it or something. So the way it worked out was, this is a cheap new car.
Yeah.
And you know, it was great up until it fucking died, but it lasted for a long time.
Remember when you got that in Lexington?
I got it in Murray when I worked at Office Depot.
Oh, did you really?
Yes.
Oh shit. Then you did have it a very long time.
Yes. Cause I remember Miller getting in the car and be like, this is nice. And that's funny to think about now.
Cause Miller doesn't ride in cars anymore.
He exclusively runs like a Wendigo. He has a lot of dogs, too.
He has an extensive amount of zip lines placed throughout the country, and Sean Miller exclusively zip lines anywhere he's trying to go.
Yeah. The Miller rope line, I think they call it.
Well, Dave, you talk about that Pac-Man? That Pac-Man 2?
Who?
Pac-Man.
Ah, Paku-Paku.
Paku-Man.
Yes, because he flaps his lips. Yeah. I learned that from Scott Pilgrim. I guess you want to talk about them?
Yeah, let's do it for a little while.
We just did Pack in Time.
It wasn't that long ago.
So what's really weird about the randomizer and how the randomizer works in mysterious ways, mm-hmm. because he's a true god, is like all true gods, they work in mysterious ways, unless they're Greek and they just fucking show up and then...
Unless they're Greek or Dungeons and Dragons.
Depends. Depends on
Depends on your DM. Right. I run my gods in D&D like Greek gods.
Which is like... The only thing that's appealing to me about running like or playing a game that's set in like within Greek mythology, is like seeing those gods, you know, like I don't know, and I guess also seeing what the magic system's like in like a Greek setting, like is it just straight up like divination, like that's all that exists, or like I guess,
yeah, because you never, I guess there's a lot of polymorphing,
transmutation,
polymorphing and divination, that's about it,
right? Yeah. And I mean, usually that all comes, like, would all the spells be, like, divine spells that come from gods? Or, like, what? Are you a heretic if you cast arcane spells?
So I guess there are arcane spells. Like, there's Hecate, who's the god of, like, magic.
Yeah, that's true. That's true. So I guess witchcraft.
They have their own bokob. Yeah, witchcraft.
Anyway, Pac-Man doesn't cast any magic. But the randomizer does work in mysterious ways. We just recently did Pack in Time, which is another Pac-Man game for the Super Nintendo. And we also just did, not too long ago, Prehistoric Man, which ties in, believe it or not, to Pac-Man 2 in two different ways. Mm-hmm. First of all, it also features hang gliding.
Oh, yeah.
Like, man... What are the only way we need to replay Pilot Wings and get like the trifecta?
Next, we get like Cliffhanger or some shit.
The second thing is that Pac-Man 2 was one of those games that you played as a kid.
Yep. Yep. That Ryan got in that little bundle of games from Molester Mom.
New title.
Yeah. Let's have Molester Mom on the show. We're far too old for her to be interested in us, so it'll be fine.
I'll wear my Jerry Bear t-shirt.
We'll do like Lip in that episode of Shameless where he shaves off all his hair and wears a too small shirt and asks for a peanut butter and jelly sandwich.
I haven't seen enough of that show. Nikki, I think Nikki's seen all of it.
Oh, God, I love Shameless. Even like it toward the end, it was really starting to spin out, but it was still good.
I've seen a lot of the sex scenes. Like, yeah. I've seen a lot of those. Yeah, but not a lot of them that I recognize.
Because Good Time Gatsby of the first One Chip Challenge video, she is good friends with the girl who is Lip's girlfriend in the first few seasons.
Really?
Like, she knows her, but she can't watch the show because seeing her friend like naked and acting like that is really weird for her. So she has a really hard time watching it.
Yeah. Would you? I don't know that I would have that problem.
Yeah.
Do you, I mean, like, Jacob's an actor. He's a friend of ours.
We've seen him make out with dudes.
Yeah. I'd watch him. I'd watch him get fucked on screen.
Yeah.
No problem. Yeah.
Screens, real life, whatever.
Whatever.
It's fine. Well, I'd watch Jacob jack off in that Spider-Man cup. It's fine. We're friends.
Again.
Not weird. Again.
I don't. Well, this is my extent.
Add your manner to the Grail. Come on.
I've seen like enough Shameless to like know the main characters because I've seen like the first two seasons. But beyond that, like whenever I see like on the subreddit, watch it for the plot. There are a bunch of Shameless seeds on there. And it's like every now and then I'll be on my phone and I'll just turn it to Nikki and be like, was that a good season? Looked like it was a good season for Lip. Was that a good season overall?
God, Lip is probably my favorite character in that show.
Of course, absolutely. He's the best. At least in the seasons that I saw.
Yeah. Pac-Man 2.
Did you like
it? The true sequel to Pac-Man. The sequel everyone wanted to Pac-Man.
The sequel we deserve.
Yeah.
Pac-Man 2. Did you like it?
This game is so fucking awful.
You didn't like it, though.
It is not. It is a good-looking game. Graphically, I think it looks good.
Yeah, it is. It's really beautiful.
It looks like a kid's game, but in no way is this a kid's game.
I don't know. I think it is. I think it was intended to be for children.
I feel like the puzzles are too obtuse. Mm-hmm. Pac-Man is far too whole. Okay, well, before we delve into it, do you hear that, Dave?
I do. That's the sound of us getting ahead of ourselves.
There's Flopsy.
And also, it's, hey, did you guys forget about me? I heard y'all talking about sex on Shameless. I didn't hear you talk about me, old Flopsy.
I'm pretty sure one of my pages has Fiona's titties in it. Come on, just page through Flopsy till you find them.
Fiona's titties are in here? All right. The ultimate Shameless guide to the SNES library, 1991 through 2017. I don't know. Is that show still going?
I think basically everyone eventually just dropped out. Enough people dropped out where it's like, okay, well, I guess we're done.
Really?
Yeah.
Of course I hear that. The neglect of the book Flopsy, which ushers in a segment that we like to call Dave Reads from the Ultimate Nintendo Guide to the SNES Library, 1991 through 1998 by Pat Contry, courtesy of Master Bowl Mike. Pac-Man 2, : The New Adventures. Genre, adventure.
Sure.
Release date, September 1994. Region, North America and PAL. Developer, Namco. Publisher, Namco. They did this to their own fucking selves. They did this to themselves. It's not like Pack in Time.
Which, in Pack in Time, what, a reskin of, like, Fury of the Furries or some shit?
Yeah. This is straight up Namco. It is a one-player game, and it features a password save.
How many stars do it got?
More than
we probably think it deserves.
3.5.
Yeah, no, definitely not.
3.5. Pac in Time got 2.5.
I like Pac in Time more than I like this game.
Me too. Pac in Time looked a lot worse.
Oh, yeah.
This game, when you said this game, it looks good.
Pac in Time had mode 6.5 graphics.
Yeah, it's bad. Pac in Time looks bad. Pac-Man 2 looks gorgeous. Mm-hmm. Like, it really does. It looks gorgeous. And it's like there were weird decisions that were made. Like, Pac-Man lives in a house that looks like himself.
Mm-hmm.
That's weird.
Like we live in our head, our own houses that look like shaped like our heads.
How did we get in your house?
I have all that shrubbery for my beard on my house. It's great.
I have two big windows.
You have giant windows that make your house 100 degrees.
There's also, if you were worried we weren't going to have another Pac-Man game, fear not.
Oh, yeah.
Eventually, the randomizer will give us Pack Attack, which is a Pac-Man puzzle game.
SNES Drunk said that one wasn't too bad. I think there is a Miss Pac-Man port for SNES.
Yeah, I think there probably is. You can also play it in this game, Pac-Man 2. Yeah.
Well, Pac-Man 2, because I know the covers, the cover art for America and PAL regions are different. PAL regions got a calm Pac-Man running down to take off in the hang glider. We got the one where Pac-Man looks like he's losing his shit in the air on the hang glider.
I'm really glad that you explained that, because when I was sending out a tweet that I was going to stream possibly the weirdest Pac-Man game in existence, just kidding, I know baby Pac-Man exists, I looked for the box art, and it's like, okay, there's two different box arts, and one of them looks like a parody of the other one. Because,
one we got looks like it's not the real one.
Right.
Yeah, 100%.
So that's what's going on. Okay, because, damn, that's so
ours
weird.
Ours looks like a Futurama head freaking out attached to a hang glider.
Yeah.
The other one looks like Pac-Man in a hang glider.
What a weird decision to make.
Yeah, it's like, just all around.
Who looked
stupid.
At that? Tom Namco looked at that and was like, kids in America aren't going to buy this unless he looks like Mr. Boogity. European kids? Straight lace. They're like very serious gamers.
Mr. Namco, what do kids nowadays
please want call me Tom
from Pac-Man? Well, I know kids nowadays love intricate management systems. So what we're gonna make is my working title is Pack Management, because that's what this game fucking is. It is Pack Management.
That's very good. I like that. For the record, you're right. Miss Pac-Man is a Super Nintendo game.
All right. We'll see you like when we get that one eventually.
I mean, yeah, I will, but it's also like, what are they going to do? There's no way it's better than Tengen Miss Pac-Man for the NES.
No.
Oh, never mind. It's one or two players simultaneous, so it'll be exactly the same.
Okay. Well, this game, okay.
Tell me about it. Pretend like I didn't torture myself by playing it.
Because, one, I really feel like it was meant to be a different game and they just put Pac-Man in it.
I don't think so.
Well, I say that because so this is like, it's supposed to be Pac-Man. Pac-Man, Miss Pac-Man, Pac-Man Jr., and Baby Pac-Man are the only Pac people in this city of humans.
Yes, but you go into the music store, you sit down at the piano, what's the piano shaped like? Pac-Man.
Maybe they all just really like Pac-Man.
You walk by buildings. What are some of the windows shaped like? Pac-Man. They must really like Pac-Man. It's kind of like, can you imagine if
this is Tokyo in 1980.
Right? What if like Bill Murray moved to our town? We'd probably just like go fucking crazy and be like, we're going to make this building look like Bill Murray. Also, all our cakes now look like Bill Murray.
Build him a house that looks like his character in Caddyshack at everything.
I like that. They moved in and the city just thrust all this on the Pac family. They're like, okay, we got your house. It looks like you. Yeah. All right. We bought you a dog. We genetically engineered you a dog that looks like you, but with dog ears and a tail.
Is he really moody? Okay. Make everyone that lives within walking distance basically hate him. All the people, all the animals, everything hates him. Everybody else, we love him outside of his walking radius.
Yeah, it's like a public decree where it's like, if you see Pac-Man on the streets, we love Pac-Man. And the reason we love Pac-Man is because he's a humble man.
Mm-hmm.
We don't want to get him. We don't want to inflate his ego. So if you do see him, either pretend like he doesn't exist or treat him like shit.
Constantly be dosing all of your animals with like some sort of sleep serum.
Yes.
And then randomly wake them up in front of him. Because this game, it sounds like we're probably talking nonsense, but...
Because we are.
Yeah.
This game is nonsense.
It is.
I'm sorry to interrupt, but I want to get in here because I think that this game is absolutely designed with Pac-Man in mind because it was developed by Namco, and it's also, apparently there was a Pac-Man cartoon. I know there was a Hanna-Barbera, old one, but I think there was a newer one around the time this game came out that featured the Ghost Witch. Who is in this game.
And there was another Pac-Man game in like 84 that was a Mario-style platformer?
I think that is Pac-Land. I'm not positive. I'm basing all this knowledge on me playing Super Smash Brothers a few times.
Pretty good. So basically you play the role of Pac-Man's guardian angel or some sort of minor god being punished by greater gods to manage Pac-Man?
Yeah, you don't get to play as Pac-Man in this game. Let's go ahead and say that. You play essentially, yeah, like a deific Dennis the Menace.
You are Marvy, god of sling shots, and you use your sling shot to make things happen to Pac-Man.
To sling shoot.
Sling shoot. Oh, it's so, but yeah, because you can't control Pac-Man. Pac-Man, one just walks around. He'll get basically orders from his family as to what to do.
That's your quest. That's his quest. I shouldn't say yours. Your quest is to help Pac-Man. Yep.
And then he just walks around and you shoot things around him to interact with him to try to get him to do the thing he's supposed to do.
He's a lemming. This game is lemmings with one giant lemming.
Yeah. Yeah.
Is what this game is. And also the lemming can't do anything.
And is the worst case of bipolar disorder you've ever seen.
Look, I mean, I think that it would absolutely benefit Pac-Man if he talked to a professional, because he really is suffering from very erratic mood swings
some
in this game.
Some manner of mood disorder, because, yeah, it does go all over the place all the time, and he becomes increasingly difficult to deal with.
Well, he won't, if he gets mad, he won't do the things that you want him to do. Like, it, like an example of that is there is a cliff. Then you got to find, you have to find a flower on this cliff for Lucy, a human who lives next door to Pac-Man.
And wants to move her couch. Yep.
Right, desperately. Which that ties in the moods too. I'm going to, let's put a pin on Lucy trying to push her couch in her own home. So you got to climb a rope to get to the top of this mountain to get a flower for Lucy. So what you have to do is Pac-Man just walks on his own.
Yep.
He just walks. And you see a rope that's like, do you want him to climb? You shoot the rope. And Pac-Man's like, ah, shit. God shot a rope with a slingshot.
Man, there's a rope. I better climb that rope.
Unless I'm upset at God, in which case I won't do that. Yeah. What God needs to do is get me in a good fucking mood. Because if I'm in a bad mood, I ain't fucking climbing that rope.
Mm-hmm.
God better show up with a balloon. He better direct me to a balloon or a rabbit that I can look at.
Mm-hmm. An apple to eat.
An apple to eat. Something.
Let's all take this worldview.
I think
every
most of us do.
Every single one of us.
I think most of us do. I think that's the problem. I was playing it. I was like,
if you're a retail worker, then yes, everyone you interact with has this mood.
Yeah, it's just it's true.
Oh my God. Because like your first quest is to get milk for baby Pac-Man.
Yeah.
Pac-Baby.
Yeah.
And, of course, it's weirdly nonsensical in the stuff that you have to do, because, one, you have to... Because, naturally, I wanted to walk left when you go out of the house, which is the wrong direction.
They do have signs, which is nice.
They do have signs and tell you.
With a milk bottle and an arrow. Weird city. Very weird city.
Well, because you immediately walk left. Of course, power pellets grow in the tree in Pac-Man's house.
Man... If we reach $600 on Patreon, I'm going to have milk signs made, and I'm going to put them up around town. That's not a
Perfect.
Joke. We have the means. I can talk to Chris Black. He's the
Et cetera
sign guy.
Coffee shop would be very down for that. Our local weird coffee shop would love signs like that around.
Who wouldn't love signs like that around? I'm sorry. You were talking power pellets.
Well, one, like you can interact with most things as Slingshot God. So, like, one, in Pac-Man's yard, you can shoot a windmill or, like, a weather vane.
Yeah, he's got a weird thing. He just has a weird, well, it's not a weather vane, like, that's on his house. He's just kind of got, like, a pole.
Standing. If you shoot it, it spins. You shoot it three times, it spins so fast, it comes off, flies around like a shuriken, chases him until he runs into his mailbox, and he falls over. Game over.
Right? That's in the tutorial. Because, like, this game, I do think it is cool that this game has a skippable level zero at the beginning of the game, where essentially Pac-Man, like, he looks at you, the player, gestures, and then walks into a television. He just walks into a television, and then all of a sudden you're playing the game. And it's like, he talks to you, and he's like, you can't control me, but you can shoot things. And he tells you, shoot that thing. And then you shoot it, and then he reacts. And then he's like, that's pretty much the game.
Why is this Pac-Man? Because I'm such a huge narcissist, I don't want to be responsible for anything in my own life. So I created you. There you are. This is actually Pac-Management Narcissist Simulator. It's always someone else's fault.
I like the philosophy of this. Yeah. Like, this is a real interesting conversation. Do all Pac-Men create their own gods?
That's the title of our book. So yeah, I naturally walk left and
no milk.
But you see, you tiptoe past a sleeping dog.
Yeah.
But there's an apple down there. You have to shoot the apple out before it would fall on its own. Otherwise, it falls on its own, bounces off Pac-Man's head, wakes up the dog. Dog comes after him.
Yeah.
But in weirder twist of fate, dog comes after you. Pac-Man panics, jumps up, grabs a limb on that tree, which then the tree becomes a slot machine.
Yeah. Which if you get all three apples on that slot machine, yeah, all the apples fall out of the tree. If you get not that, the dog kills you.
Yep.
It's pretty much Russian roulette.
So yeah, you come to
with extra steps.
Russian roulette with extra steps.
Apples and dogs and trees.
Because yeah, shoot that apple down so you can keep going. You can go into Lucy's house where she's struggling to push her couch.
All right. Back to Lucy. Mm. And this ties into what you're explaining. That whole thing with like walking by the dog and stuff. Pac-Man's mood determines what happens, like what events trigger, which is a cool concept, mm-hmm, but horrible in practice.
Yeah.
Because it's like, if you don't know that, you can't work around it. Yeah. You know, like it's
and
just
his moods flip over anything and everything.
Yes. And the problem is you have no idea what is going to happen until you try it, which I guess could be fun if you're a child with unlimited time.
Yeah.
That's why I think this is absolutely a kid's game, but it's still a bad game. But
it's a kid's game. Don't know what kid, but it's a kid's game.
Yeah. This is tough, man. I think that if I had this game as
hey,
a kid.
Do you like this Pac-Man arcade game you may have never heard of? This is for you. So who is this for?
I played a lot. Look, I'll tell you who this is for. It's for me, who only played DOS games.
But 30 years ago.
For a very long, yes, me 30 years ago, who has a PC with DOS on it, and I play games that are very similar to this because I don't have a real game console. If you would have given this to me when I was 8, it would have been like, holy shit, this is awesome.
Man, Pac-Man 2 is even better than Pac-Man.
Well, let's not go that far. I get your point, and I agree with it. It is nowhere near as good as Pac-Man.
But don't ever say that again.
But you've insulted me. But anyway, so right, okay, we're talking about how the moods Pac-Man's moods influence events that happen.
Mm-hmm.
And you're talking about Lucy in her house pushing the couch.
Yep.
It is possible to get Pac-Man so happy that he becomes psychotic, essentially. He struts around. Have you seen this? He struts around with this smug look on his face.
Yeah.
And he went into Lucy's house. She's struggling to push on the couch. He walks up to the couch, struts up, jumps on the couch, and starts bouncing on it. And she starts crying, and then he gets down, starts whistling, and walks out of her house.
Here you go, kids. You know what's funny? Hurting people.
Also, I've had the thing where he gets so smug that it's like he's walking. Oh, man, he is so fucking happy. He sees the balloons.
He just ate an apple and saw a rabbit. Right? He's so fucking happy.
I saw a rabbit. I ate an apple. You know what I'm going to do? I'm going to pop this fucking balloon at this balloon stand.
God.
Why? That doesn't make any sense. But that's what triggers if you're smug and walk past the balloon vendor. He pulls out a needle and pops a balloon. Unless you shoot him first.
You have to temper it. Like, Pac-Man can't be too happy or too sad.
Pac-Man can have a little sad.
Preferably the best way any person should be is a little sad.
I'm philosophy. I think this game is trying to tell us things.
Because if you're too happy, you hurt other people. But yeah, eventually then you see a sign that says, oh, turn around, milk's the other way. Walk the other way to a farm you find. You can walk past a city where there's a sleeping cat, you hit the cat kills Pac-Man.
Yeah, lots of things will kill Pac-Man that you think that might not.
Yep.
Paint bucket. If paint flies up in the air and then lands on your head, I've seen Home Alone. I know that doesn't kill a man.
No matter what velocity.
Won't kill a man. Kill Pac-Man, though.
Yeah, because you bump into this sign where a man is painting a sign. You bump into it, knock the whole thing down because you're angry at it.
Yeah, you just kick it. You just kick the scaffolding to murder this man who is just trying to put up a billboard of the best art in the entire fucking game. I fucking love this. It will be the episode art. No one will get it. I don't care. It's the best. It is, honestly, it might be the best art in a Super Nintendo game ever. This might be it. This is probably why I got 3.5 stars in the Ultimate Nintendo Guide to the SNES Library 1991 through 1998 by Pat Contry, courtesy of Master Mole Mike. It is a bright blue billboard with a giant kid or giant redhead kid just eating a huge hamburger. And it looks so good. Like, it looks better than the rest of the game.
Yeah.
I fucking love it. Anyway, I'm sorry. I had to gush over this billboard.
Because I remember I was in your stream for that part. You were like, I fucking love this.
It's the best. I would wear that on a shirt, a bumper sticker.
Just a blue shirt with that kid eating a giant hamburger.
I'm gonna go to our local burger joint, just hamburgers, and I'm just going to slide them a card with that on it and giggle.
And hopefully they like just nod and slide you a hamburger back, and you stand in that pose for 6 hours.
The hamburger's in the shape of Pac-Man. They get it there.
Oh, that's probably one. Okay. But you walk through the city to the farm where the farmer is going to chew you out. So you have to knock a hay bale down onto the farmer so Pac-Man can get past the farmer.
With your slingshot.
With your slingshot. To the cow, but if you shoot the cow while Pac-Man is close to it, the cow's tail will hit you and kill Pac-Man.
Yeah, that's also a bull.
Oh, it's a there you go. Yes, milk bull.
I milked your cow.
There's a chicken in a pen. If you use your slingshot and free the chicken, it will then run into a tree and free bees that kill Pac-Man.
Right.
It's sort of like a weird version of Clock Tower in that there's just a lot of weird shit that'll just kill you if you're not quite ready for it.
Or Final Destination. Yeah. Did Final Destination ever get a video game? Because if it didn't, this is why.
Because what you have to do is there's a pedestal with a milk bottle sitting on it that just says free.
Mm-hmm.
Pac-Man can't quite reach it, so once he's reaching it, you have to shoot a raven on a telephone line that'll swoop down and knock it off and scare Pac-Man. And then you steal the milk from the cow.
But wait, I want to pause there for a moment. If you hadn't told me to do that when I was streaming the game, I would have been there for 3 hours.
Yeah, there's no way you would really understand that's the way it works.
Because
you shoot it too much, the bottle breaks. You can't knock it down for Pac-Man, which is what you would think you do.
Right.
Nope, shoot it twice and it shatters.
And this is why I inherently hate adventure games.
Yeah.
I hate this shit. I hate this bullshit where it's just like, what's the connection? How am I supposed to figure out what's the logic here?
Mm-hmm.
Other than just shooting everything on the screen, which is the logic. That's what they want you to do. They want you to shoot everything on the screen to see if it gives you the desired effect that you want.
But most of it just kills you.
Absolutely.
So it's counterintuitive.
It's not fun. That's what makes this game not fun. Yeah. Is that. It's but at least
there's
it's
like the fucking skateboard.
Yes, there's a skateboard where it's like you're walking because you're not walking. Pac-Man's walking, trips over a rock, gets up, steps on a skateboard that flies up in the air, and you have to tell Pac-Man to look up because he's an idiot and forgot that he just sent a skateboard flying up. You have to make him look up and see the skateboard and for him to step to the side. Otherwise, it lands on him and kills him.
And the controls, even telling Pac-Man what to do is wonky.
Yes, because you can tell him to look, and you know that you tell him to look because there's a sound clip of, look, 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 look. And you hold down the Y button and point in the direction that you want him to look. And again, he might be feeling bad. He might be mad. He might be angry and might not cooperate. So it's really frustrating.
Mm-hmm.
It's frustrating on multiple levels. It's frustrating in that the same way that all adventure games are frustrating.
Yep.
And frustrating in the fact that
you had to restart at one point.
Yeah.
Because he was so mad he wouldn't do anything.
He was so mad, and I had him on a building, at the top of a building, And he wouldn't do it. He would just, he just stood there walking back and forth.
Mm-hmm. And with, then with even, a little like Charlie Brown anger speech bubble.
And then, with like the
looked
scribbles.
Like pig pen, mm-hmm. Yeah.
I had to reset it. And it's like, someone in chat was like, I've never seen that happen before. I was like, well, me neither, because I've never played it before. But I'm glad this isn't like a super common occurrence.
So yeah, once you get that milk,
yeah.
Milk that cow, walk back.
Yeah.
Then you start the real adventure. Then you see Pac-Man 2, and then you have to...
They do that every time you finish a quest. They show you the title screen again, where it's like...
All right, now the real game started. Okay, well, now the real game is started.
Okay, you finished the second quest. Now the real game started. And this is where they give you the passwords, too. Yeah. So it's nice that they give you a password, because it would really suck to like start this game over from the very beginning.
Of course, then the second level is the glory of the hang glider, trying to find a flower for Lucy's birthday.
Right.
But of course, I guess it's not so bad because you actually get to control that.
This was actually, I think, one of the better parts of the game that I played. Even though it was still kind of frustrating, it was only frustrating because I had to memorize where the ghosts were who were going to throw boulders at me.
Or plungers.
Or plungers with a boxing glove on it. but you don't really get to control Pac-Man. You're still Slingshot God. Well, I guess you're right. You do, if you press Y, you do make him go up, but you have to shoot him to make him go down.
Yeah. Which is, that doesn't make any sense to me either.
We've also failed to mention, we've mentioned the fact that you have a slingshot. This is all first person view. Mm-hmm. It's essentially like you are watching this from your eyes and you can float along with Pac-Man. And you move the cursor where you're going to shoot with the D-pad. Mm-hmm. The game does not work with the SNES mouse.
See, that's even more dumb that it doesn't.
And that's weird.
But, yeah, you eventually get through a very long hang glider scene to the top of a mountain, pick a flower, give it to a little girl. You can also walk off the edge of that cliff and die.
Yeah, he will get... This happened to me. He will get sad if you don't know what to do, like up on the cliff. Because he'll walk and he'll look down off the ledge. And every time he looks down, he gets sad. And like, if you don't know what to do, he'll just keep walking over to the cliff and get sadder and sadder and sadder. He literally walked off. He got so sad that he literally walked
off
the
cliff.
Killed himself. He literally did that.
The kid's game.
The kid's game.
No. Are you sad your mom wouldn't buy you that toy? We'll show her.
How sad are you? I don't, that was, look, I get it. It's 1994. But
a field full of flowers will make a wonderful grave.
But at the same time, it was like, okay, I guess that's just how it is. I know what it was. It was the game, it was the designer being like, well, they don't figure it out by this point.
Fuck them.
Fuck them. Exactly.
We got their money. Fuck them.
This is the definition of a disappointing rental.
Oh.
That's what this is.
So I remember playing it with Ryan and him, like, oh, I got Pac-Man 2, and I sat down like, why can't I control Pac-Man? What the fuck am I doing?
Why is this nothing like Pac-Man?
Nothing at all. Like, I'm just shooting shit. Can I shoot Pac-Man? Oh, okay, now he's not doing anything. Turn it off. Put in Prehistoric Man. At least that I know what's going on.
And it's fucked up because it's like, you can shoot Pac-Man, but like sometimes you shoot Pac-Man and it makes him sad. Sometimes you shoot Pac-Man and he jumps. Where it's like, there's a lot of difference between those two things. So I'm always questioning, do I shoot Pac-Man now or not?
That's what you would think. Like, he can't reach that milk bottle. Shoot and make him jump.
Right.
No. Shoot that crow. Shoot that raven up there. Make it swoop down.
Sometimes I shoot him so he doesn't die. Like, if he ever gets, like, dizzy, like, sometimes he'll fall down and it's like, shoot him and he'll get up.
Did you beat this game?
No, but I did get to the last stage. This is a short game. There are only four quests. So the third quest, after you get the flower for Lucy, the third quest has the best premise in the game, as far as I'm concerned. Like, okay, take yourself out of this game for a moment. And let's pitch it as like, I don't know, like a Nickelodeon show where it's like a Nickelodeon 1 hour standalone thing.
You can't do that in pack management.
Right? All right. So you're playing your guitar and then three ghosts show up and steal that guitar.
Hell yeah.
And then your dad's got to go get it from those ghosts.
But those ghosts also work for an evil witch.
Right. Those ghosts also...
Who's also the antagonist in Pack in Time.
Yeah, see, I didn't get far enough in that. I'm definitely going to take your word for that. But like those ghosts who stole the guitar also do that thing, do the three kids in a trench coat thing, and pretend to be a security guard.
Yes.
That's how you get your guitar back, is you got to find the security guard who is made up of ghosts, three ghosts.
They all are.
And yeah, right. And you have to fight him.
Hank, the security guard from the office, he's a ghost.
And in order to fight him, you have to get Pac-Man. You guessed it. You got to get him mad. Yeah, you got to get him really mad, and then Pac-Man will fight the security guard. And then they turn into ghosts. And then you have to use a power pellet to turn Pac-Man into Super Pac-Man. Mm-hmm. We haven't talked about that
yet. Yep.
If you run into ghosts and do not have a power pellet, they will scare you to death. And it takes a long time, because what it does is it's like a damage over time, or like a condition effect in a role-playing game, essentially, where it's like if you're in a great mood and you encounter ghosts, they'll scare you, you'll fall down, you'll wake up, and your mood will be different. It'll be a little worse. Nah. Then they do it again, and it'll be a little worse. And then they do it again, and then you're dead. Instead of just out, I don't know. It just seems like if you don't have a power pellet and you run across ghosts, just go ahead and kill me. Don't make me
swarm him, and then he's...
Yeah, I don't want to see Pac-Man spiraling out of control until he dies. I just want... Get it over with quick.
I want to... You know, it's the right thing to do to get so angry you attack an authority figure, kids. It's good.
But when you do...
When someone at the movies won't let you in the movie theater, fight them.
Shoot them in the face with a slingshot.
And whenever they come at you, turn into a superhero, bite them.
Dude, Super Pac-Man looks like if Pac-Man were cosplaying as Booger Man. That's what he looks like. But when the ghosts do kill you, the animation's fantastic. They laugh at you and stick out their tongue. The game, I want to say again, since we are shitting on it, The game is gorgeous.
Yeah.
It is gorgeous.
Looks very good.
Especially for 1994. That was not like real late into, that's like the beginning of the middle ages of Super Nintendo. Yep. It's a very, very, very good looking game. Mm-hmm. It is worth checking out, I think, for that. And by that, I mean, don't play it.
Watch a YouTube video.
Watch the GDQ speedrun. Yeah, by Party Man X. That's what I watched. Because I was like, I want to see the end of this game, but do not want to.
What's the record for beating it?
It's a little over 20 minutes. I knew Grim looked it up while I was streaming. And I think it's like 21 minutes and a few seconds.
Okay.
But like in order to get it, like watching the GDQ run, you have to do really weird shit. Like, you know how like you were talking about at the farm? If you shoot the chicken coop and the chicken runs out, Pac-Man gets scared because he's fucking scared of everything. Mm-hmm. And then a beehive will fall out of the tree. So the speedrunner's strategy was, okay, the chicken scares Pac-Man, makes Pac-Man go fast. Fast is good. But if I shoot Pac-Man right before he gets to the tree, he jumps behind the tree and the beehive doesn't fall down. So it's like, that's what the speedrun is. It's all of these like shortcuts for like, manipulating Pac-Man. So it's like, which is like speedrunning, because it's all about finding shortcuts and
it's like
those.
Management.
But it is absolutely like management. And then there's also a minecart level that I didn't even get to.
Yep.
Because I didn't know it, outside of the instruction manual, I didn't know that it existed. I thought that I would eventually find it. Nope, didn't. Because like every screen in the game kind of connects with another screen. It's kind of like River City Ransom in that regard, where it's like it's this big city that all connects together. That's cool. I like that. Mm-hmm. But man, the game mechanics absolutely destroy this game. Like the fact that you have to like hunt and peck and like just shoot random things to see what happens, and the fact that you don't directly control Pac-Man, I think it's really shitty. I think it's a really broken idea for a game.
Yep.
It's an interesting idea. Like, it's a real ballsy idea. Mm-hmm. And I imagine, like, Tom Namco...
So was Fable 3.
Yeah. Mm. Yeah. I imagine Tom Namco was like, fuck, we are barely relevant. Time to do something ballsy.
What's our proper Pac-Man? Yeah, go ahead, Pac-Man.
Of course it's Pac-Man.
Yep.
Yeah.
But the final boss in this game being the ABC monster. Yeah,
the ABC gum monster.
Yep.
Already been chewed gum.
Yep.
The so what happens is the ghost witch decides to steal all of the kids' gum in the city.
Mm-hmm.
The ABC gum. And then she makes a gum golem, essentially, out of it.
A gumlum?
A gumlum, yeah. And then there's a boss fight.
Which is basically what Pac-Man flies around eating ghosts while you shoot your slingshot until the gum monster dies.
That's what it looked like. I don't know. I didn't play that. I didn't get that far.
It looks
but
like
is
a really
like.
Bad final thing.
It's also a boss in an adventure game. So it's like, I don't know. Maybe you should look. I realize you got to the end of this game and you're like, is this working? No? All right. Fight a boss?
And just call it. Fuck it, we'll do it live.
You do that in video games, right? Fight bosses? So, yeah. The game sucks.
Yeah, it does.
I think it sucks. I think that the Ultimate Nintendo Guide to the SNES Library 1991 through 1998 by Pat Contry, courtesy of Master Roll Mike, is wrong.
Yep.
I don't think this is a 3.5-star game.
I agree.
Unless they're basing that just on looks.
Yeah.
Because it honestly is a very good-looking game. The sound sucks. The music is very much like they played Super Mario World. And we're like, let's make it sound kind of like that.
Change it enough that we don't get sued.
Pretty much. And that's just really for like one area of the city. And then the rest of the music is like, just like fart noises pretty much. It's like, you know, that like, it's like that stuff. And it's like, who enjoys this?
Someone in Mario Paint who just puts the music boxes everywhere.
Look, man. If they would have made the soundtrack in Mario Paint and done it all with cats... I'm in. Nothing brings me more joy than like listening to a Mario Paint song and like doom 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 doom
meow.
Like the meow just like sets me off, man, in a good way. It's like, all right, this is gonna be a good day.
Oh man.
Have you ever seen Collective Soul Cat?
Yes. Yes, fuck. Yeah. I haven't thought about that in a while.
We need to remake that. But the cat's meow is actually replaced by the meow in Mario Paint.
Well, do you have any achievements for this game?
I have the largest number of achievements submitted through Twitch chat that I have ever had.
So everybody loved this.
I have never had this many achievements submitted before. And like when I was looking them up, you saw me. It was like, holy shit. I was like, this can't be right. This cannot be right. There cannot be that many. There were like fucking 20. There were like 20 achievements pretty much. Here are my favorites.
Okay.
You mean to tell me you're done? You're done talking? You're done talking about Pac-Man 2?
Yes.
All right. First achievement. Comes in from Bovine Bear. I'm sorry, Pac-Man. Your ghost is in another castle. And in order to unlock, I'm sorry, Pac-Man. Your ghost is in another castle. Turn off Pac-Man 2 and play a better oddball sequel like Super Mario Brothers 2.
Fair.
Like, it's fine if you do something different with the game, right? Just make it good.
Yeah, like, I love Zelda 2. You know, Venture of Link. I love that. And that is a radical departure.
Absolutely.
Not as radical as this game is a departure, though.
Very true. You can control Link in Zelda 2. Next achievement I've got comes in from Dr. Drunk, a.k.a., and that is squeezing them pack nips, which, goddamn, when he said that in chat, delighted the shit out of me. Thinking about Miss Pac-Man having nipples.
How do you milk Miss Pac-Man?
You can milk anything with nipples, Greg.
I guess she doesn't have any, so you can't.
I mean, maybe that's why they need milk.
Yeah.
Also, I want to point out...
Pac-Babies exclusively feed from cows.
I want to point out, isn't it illegal to give a baby raw milk?
Yeah.
Isn't it illegal to sell raw milk?
And it's dumb. That's why you steal it.
That's also why it's free.
Yeah. It's free because fucking John Law's on my ass about my raw milk.
In order to unlock squeezing them pack nips, you got to milk the cow for pack kid, not the bull for pack wife. Next achievement I got comes in from Dan, Rude Awakening. In order to unlock Rude Awakening, you need to shoot Pac-Man in the balls to wake him up, which is every time he would fall down, you pretty much, he spreads eagle for you.
Yeah.
Because he falls down, spread eagle, and you got to shoot him to get him up. So you're constantly shooting him in the balls and tank.
I guess Pac-Man's mouth is a cloaca or whatever, because he has one hole for everything.
It's a utiliport. It's an intake and an exhaust and a reproductive organ. And the last.
Which leads very much a lot of questions about how Miss Pac-Man got pregnant, Miss Pac-Man gave birth. So.
Oh, yeah. Baby Pac, they came out of that mouth.
Yeah. Come goes in, baby comes out.
Either that or, all right, so here's what I think really happened. So Miss Pac-Man one day slowly forced an egg out of her mouth, and then Pac-Man came over and fertilized
it. So they're not mammals.
No. No. Okay. Have you ever seen a mammal look like a Pac-Man? Or maybe they're like, they kind of look like single-cell organisms. They just, yeah. Normally, a Pac-Man would be in a shell. But this one has decided to move into a house shaped like himself instead.
Yeah, exactly.
The next achievement I have comes in from Zal, who is the moderator extraordinaire on Twitch. Thank you, Zal. The achievement is The Real Game. And in order to unlock The Real Game, you need to find the game within the game and play that instead, because it's good, and Pac-Man 2 is not.
Yeah.
We mentioned it briefly, but you can play in this Pac-Man village. There is an arcade where they have a Pac-Man machine, and you can play Pac-Man. And you can play Pac-Man, and if you beat the high score of 20,000, you get a power pellet. Or you could do it much quicker by going back to Pac-Man's house where he has power pellets in the tree.
That's so fucking dumb.
But I get it. If you want to look, it's a smart move to put the good game inside the bad game.
It is a smart move, but it should have some sort of different reward. So it stops as soon as you hit 20,000.
No, it doesn't stop. You can keep going, but truly, like, there's no point of going on beyond that other than the fact that it is more fun than the real game that you're playing. You can also unlock Miss Pac-Man. By collecting 3 Miss Pac-Man cartridges, which are hidden all throughout Pac-Land. Let me tell you where you can find one. Do you want a pro tip where you can find one?
Yeah, give me that pro tip.
Let me just give you, I just want everyone to get an idea of how easy these are to find. All right, so remember that rooftop I was talking about where Pac-Man got stuck? If you manage to make it to the next roof over, there are 3 trash cans on that roof. If you shoot the middle trash can enough times that Pac-Man gets angry and kicks it, you find a cartridge in there. It doesn't happen on the first shot. Like, you have to hit it like 4 or 5 times, and then Pac-Man's like, all right, I guess I'll kick this thing. He kicks it, and then there's a cartridge there.
He hates these cans.
God, what do you want? Kick it? The cartridge made me think there are also other items that drop. Like when you use the power pellet and eat a ghost, they'll drop an ID card. And you need to collect, I think, 3 ID cards in order to access the ghost factory, which the ghost witch is making ghosts. And that's where you fight the gum monster. But if you don't have the three ID cards, you can't access the final level.
It's like Doom. You gotta have those key cards.
Yeah. Tyler.
Yes, Dave.
Do you have any achievements for this game?
I've got one. True Pacception.
Okay.
And that is where you go inside the game, and get a kill screen on Pac-Man.
Shit. I may or may not have. Out of my 20 achievements, 20 or so achievements, I think one of those is in there.
Okay, good. Perfect.
Tyler.
Yes, Dave.
Out of all the people in the world that I could possibly dream of going through this experience with me, I'm glad that it was you.
That Phil Hawkins was there.
Yeah, I'm so glad that Phil was there. I can't imagine talking about Pac-Man 2, : The New Adventures with any other person.
Thank you.
I do have some questions for you, though.
Perfect.
How much do you think that this game is loose for the Super Nintendo, not the Genesis? There is a Genesis version.
Yep. Because there are multiple versions, it's got to make it a little bit cheaper. Namco probably really wanted to push this. It's a Pac-Man property. 1260.
Tyler, actual retail value of Pac-Man 2 : The New Adventures loose for the Super Nintendo, on average, according to PriceCharting.com, at the time of this recording, is $3.87.
All right.
I got it for two.
Nice.
I own this game. I'm the proud owner of Pac-Man 2.
All right. That's all right. I bought it for $2.
And it was $2. $2 free shipping.
Fuck yeah, then.
Someone really just wanted to get rid of this game.
Someone sealed their dead dog soul into this to get rid of it.
Oh, did I forget to mention that this cartridge is haunted? $2 or
my
best
dog's
offer.
Angry soul will make Pac-Man so mad he won't do anything. It's cursed.
You want to take a guess at how much this game is new? New.
$35.
Very good. $29.52. You were close. I'd buy it.
Yeah.
$30? Yeah.
For a new
sealed copy of Pac-Man 2. Absolutely. I'd pay $30 just for the novelty of it. Mm. Economy's good. I hear that. I don't see the benefits of that, but I hear it's good. $30? Yeah, you bet.
Yeah, my fucking glasses bill going through the fucking roof, but sure, the economy's good. I hear it is. All right, whatever.
My glasses
Pac-Man
bill.
2.
Glasses bill is going through the fucking roof, but I'm still going to buy Pac-Man 2 if I can find it new for $30. Tyler.
Yes, Dave.
I have another question for you.
Yes.
If you were to give this game a beard that sums up how you feel about it, what kind of beard would it be?
I would have to give this the beard of, because I call this game Pac Management, because I think it's managing Pac-Man. So probably one of the worst managers I have ever had at my previous job. I have to give this his beard, previous boss beard, because he was an awful manager.
Did he shoot you with a slingshot?
He basically shot me with slingshots, but he didn't even know what he was doing with that. So
hey, Tyler, I'm going to need you to get on that hang glider, and if I want you to go down, I'm just going to shoot you. Is that okay?
Because he was a manager who, he made one move. I was like, all right, I can respect that. He came out. He was like, I'm going to work a day with each of you in your job so I know exactly what your days look like. I need to know how this kitchen runs. I want to get in there and I want to understand.
Had he just discovered Undercover Boss?
We knew who he was.
He wore a mustache.
Hello. I'll help you chop this celery. They called me Celery Chopper. And I was like, okay, that's pretty cool. He was like, all right, Tyler, I'm going to work with you first. All right, cool. So the next day he showed up 3 hours late to where I would have been. He helped me do prep for about 30 minutes, and then he disappeared for the rest of the day and then never helped anyone else in the kitchen again.
And then shot me with a slingshot for the next 2 hours. Yeah.
At that point, that's when I was like, okay. Yeah, all right.
Don't worry, I'm shooting grapes. This isn't assault. Tyler.
Yes, Dave.
If you were to give this game a pair of glasses, what kind of glasses
him
would they
too
be?
He had glasses and a beard. So yeah,
and why would they be my chewed up glasses?
Perfect. Yeah, that's very good. Show him that your chewed up glasses. It's like my Oakleys that were eaten by that kid at church during that play Heaven's Gates and Hell's Flames.
Wait, what? Say that again?
I had a pair of Oakleys that I lent the church in their program because one of the characters needed to be badass and wear glasses. So I was like, okay, here are my Oakleys.
Hey, Jesus wore Oakleys, right? Yeah. Does anyone have Oakleys? I think it was a devious plan.
So I was like, I've got these fake ones. So I remember I loaned them to him and I came back. I did a scene, went to the bathroom, went to lunch, came back, and like a dog chewed up your glasses, a little kid just had mine, just fucking going to town, completely destroyed them.
How old are we talking?
Completely.
Here?
I couldn't even tell you. 10 or under.
10 is a 10 is that's a high age for chewing up someone's glasses.
Yeah.
Were they coping with something? Or?
He chewed off, but most importantly, he chewed off the Oakley branding that was on it. So these just look like glasses now. I can't wear these fake Oakleys that my mom paid $7 for.
You chewed off the best part.
You chewed off the only part my middle school ass cares about.
Hey, man, I get it. I also went to middle school. I understand.
Oh, man, the worst. God, middle school is just the worst. Elementary school, high school were so much better. Middle school was just the worst.
The beginning of high school sucked, but like by about the middle, it was good. But yeah, middle school, yeah, it sucked. Not really, really not looking forward to Henry like hitting those years. Man, it's gonna be tough on him.
I'm glad RTAJ is just about done. Just about done.
How's he going? How's it going for her? She seems
pretty good for the most part. But that's where people care more about branding than anything else. Yeah. They all like, oh my God, Vans, everything. Or do you guys skate? No, just Vans, everything. YouTube merch, Vans, everything.
Vans?
Meanwhile.
Vans are back?
Oh yeah, in POG form.
In POG form?
Like that's what, Vans, everything.
Really?
Oh yeah.
So by the time Henry's in middle school, it'll be Skechers.
It'll be Skechers. They'll be back.
Yeah. Or Doc Martens.
Skechers jellies. Doc Martens. Huge clunky boots. Yeah. Yeah, because chokers were back for a while, so it was just like Vans and chokers and shit. And then, but of course, Brandy Gadsby, who is now in high school, a junior. I love to see that she's beyond all of that.
That's
like,
good.
She was like that in middle school, but now that she is. It is nice to see, like, okay, well, some things don't change when that shit matters in middle school.
Yeah.
And getting to high school a little more doesn't fucking matter.
I remember reaching that age. Yeah. That was such a, like, nice feeling. And I remember when I worked with Brandon at Apex, I remember he wanted an Abercrombie & Fitch shirt really bad. Oh. So I took his white shirt while he was wearing it and wrote Abercrombie
you
& Fitch
did that?
On it in Sharpie. Yeah. At work. I did that at Apex.
Oh, he wore it to school and fucking claimed credit for that shit. He talked like he was the most brilliant motherfucker on the planet because this is what he did.
Well, I take that as a compliment.
Everybody loved it. It was hilarious.
I used to be
Everybody
really
loved it.
I used to be really funny. I don't know if you knew that. And then, I don't know.
I still tell that story to people that Brandon did that, and that was you.
That was me.
Small world.
That was me. That was me. Yeah, that was me.
Brandon used to lie to me about a lot of shit to look cool. A lot of shit. It's like, I'm your friend anyway, man. You don't have to fucking lie to me.
Maybe he did it. Maybe he liked the idea and then did it himself after.
It looked like better. Now that I think about it, it looked like better handwriting like you would have and not him. So it all makes sense in my head now. Lines up with my head canon.
Did he also tell you about us eating nachos fajitas chicken regularly on the floor at work? That's when we discovered that, man, people shed a lot of pubes. They wind up on the floor.
I remember he used to give me shit about liking video games so much until you, then he's like, okay, video games are cool. All right, I know this guy who I think is cool who plays video games. So like, all right, Todd, maybe you weren't wrong our whole lives.
I don't think that.
I'll give him credit. He did think Earthbound was cool from the get-go.
Yeah.
I'll give him that.
I don't think it was just me.
Let me tell him about like Chrono Trigger. He's like, you spend hours playing this money fucking come out of the Nintendo when you're done with it? Why the fuck are you playing 30 hours on this shit?
I don't think that was me. I think that was probably just the culture, work culture.
No, it was 100% you specifically. Right. His girlfriend told me so. Because whenever she called him out on it, that is one of the angriest I've ever seen him.
Well...
Oh, Dave. Dave's the coolest motherfucker.
I also used to be really cool. I don't know. Now he's
Dave's
like...
so cool. Now he's my best friend, Brandon, and we don't even see you anymore.
Come here. Let me write on your shirt. Oh, fuck. I didn't get to see Brandon when he was in town last. I wish that I had.
I hope he comes to prom.
I hope so, too. Mm-hmm. I did ask if he wanted to... He said he hinted that he was going to be there, and then I asked if he needed a room, and we had not heard back from him.
I was part of that text, and yeah, you're right. He never responded.
So it's just like, okay, I mean...
He'll take care of his own shit.
He'll take care of it. Yeah, it'll be fine.
Either he won't be there, or he'll take care of his own shit.
Right.
That's just how it is. Got any more of them questions, Dave?
Tyler.
Yes, Dave.
I do have some questions for you. We got a quiz that came in from... Inquisitor? Quiz?
Prime Inquisitor.
Prime Inquisitor. Ross Rachel Green, entitled The G-Spot.
Nice.
the G-spot. I heard recently that the G-spot isn't actually a thing. Comments on that?
I would have questioned it before Melissa, but now I know there's a G-spot.
I asked you that because I knew.
Yeah.
I wanted to give you an opportunity to brag. Ross continues, the G-spot isn't actually a thing, and that the nerves that service the clitoris just run a long way back into the pelvic wall. So it's still the same thing.
You run a long way back into the pelvic wall.
That'd be the same thing, even though it's, like, even if it were an extension of the clitoris, that's still, like, the
spot. Some nerve endings to hit. Yeah.
Yeah. Ross continues, who the fuck knows? It's hard enough to find either. Clitoris pretty, easy. That was pretty easy. That being said,
I hope every time Ross tries to find the clit, it's like when he tried to push that one dude's car to help. He just ends up bruised and bloody on the ground.
Breaking an arm. That being said, these G's should be much easier to guess.
Maybe.
Are you ready, Tyler?
Yes.
Question one. This is a beat-em-up based on a popular regional wrestling association. Guacamole.
Nice.
Is my guess.
I had no clue. Guacamole, 100%.
Because I was sitting here like, what wrestling games have we talked about? Yeah, none.
Not many.
What episode number do you think Guacamole was?
Like 86.
55, okay. Guacamole. Man, that was so fucking
that
early.
That feels like,
on. Yeah,
it doesn't feel like it was.
Good Lord.
That must have been a very early Other Shit Monday.
And I bet that game feels dated as fuck because it had all the, like, the current popular memes at the time.
Yep.
Like, that game is a time capsule. I want to play it when it's 10 years old.
Yep.
And just be like, I'm mortal. I'm going to die.
I am error. Oh, yes.
Next question. This is the third in a series of side-scrolling shooters by Konami.
Gradius.
Gradius.
What episode number do you think that was?
Oh, 86.
Gradius 3, I think we should probably go ahead and say.
Yep.
86. It is 78. Right. Close. Gradius 3. See, we've learned how to properly say Gradius. Next question. Thank you, gaming historian. This walking simulator saw you trying to find out where your family is absent. Gone Home.
Good call.
Gone
yes.
Home. That was a good game.
It was, God, such a good game. Amazing game.
What episode number do you think
86.
That was? 86. Locking it in. It was 85.
Damn.
Ooh. 85. Gone Home.
Also in the bio, in the same universe as BioShock.
Gone Home?
Mm-hmm.
Have we talked about this? Have you told me this?
A long time ago.
Refresh me.
There is like a magazine or
a
Nintendo game that is mentioned in both games.
Okay. Mm-hmm. I do now remember you mentioning that. I think my like cynical asshole-ism was just like, well, that was just the developer trying to like cash in on like forever be known because
sure.
They're tying into BioShock.
Yeah. Yeah.
I'm not saying that I wouldn't do the same thing. I'm just saying I see
what
you did
there. We also exist in the BioShock universe.
We're going to do a whole episode on that Nintendo game. That
Hand me that vigor, that Death Wish vigor, Dave.
Oh, you mean the Spider-Man cup full of man juice?
Yeah, the Death Wish vigor. Full
of grandpa's piss?
Grandpa's monster piss?
Next question.
It's got what George Washington craves.
Next question. This game is the sequel to a movie Tyler tells everyone he has watched but actually has not.
Goonies!
That's Goonies 2.
Two. Yep.
With a mermaid in it.
Yep.
What episode number do you think that was?
86.
86.
We haven't passed it yet.
Logging it in is 105. Goonies 2.
All right.
Next question. This rhythm action game features a talking dog. This rhythm action game, Guitaru Man.
Oh.
Guitaru Man.
All right.
I forgot about it.
Very good.
Puma.
Very good.
The apt name. I love Guitaru Man.
Oh, no, it's fucking amazing.
I mean, like, we'll just watch it on YouTube.
Ramon gave us D&D and Guitaru Man.
Absolutely.
God bless him.
Absolutely. What episode number do you think it was?
112.
I hope you get it just so I can say you win. It's 209. Mm. Guitaru Man. Let's do another episode on Guitaru Man.
I'm down.
All right. Is there a randomizer? Is there like Guitaru Man randomizer?
God, yes.
Where it's just, they just throw random notes at you?
Just smoke on the water, but it's Guitaru Man.
Dude, has anyone hacked Guitaru Man? Like, you know how like they like hack like Rock Band and shit like that? Dude, someone do that. I'll pay you money. Next question.
I'll trade you a copy of Pac-Man 2.
Yeah. It has a dog's soul in it, I hear. Next question. This run and gun game featured a stage called the Dice Palace.
Gunstar Heroes. Worst level. Love that game. Hate that fucking level.
Did you hate it when it was replicated in Cuphead?
I never got that far in Cuphead.
They do that thing where you roll the dice and then you fight a boss depending on what you roll.
Yeah.
What episode number do you think Gunstar Heroes was?
That was way later on, like 356.
Locking it in. 367.
Okay.
Gunstar Heroes.
Yeah.
Next question. These two games feature the same three characters, and while the first was an arcade smash, the second was only on home consoles. Would you like for me to read that again?
Sure.
It's a long one. These two games feature the same three characters, and while the first was an arcade smash, the second was only on home consoles.
Mm.
Guy, Final Fight.
I'm trying to think. All right, geez. Same three characters.
And it would have been after the Genesis games.
Ooh, yeah. Okay, good call.
Because the last one was Gunstar Heroes, which was on when we were doing, what was it? Was it Dorkly's Top 25?
In 64?
No, that was in 64. Whose list did we do for Genesis?
I don't remember.
Yeah. Pornhub's. Pornhub's 20 top Genesis games.
Oh, game.
You know what's really nice and also weird is there are people listening to this podcast that know more about the podcast than we do.
Mm-hmm. I love it.
It
humbles my heart.
I'm often embarrassed when someone will mention an episode we did, and I'm like, we did an episode on that?
No, we did. Sword of Vermillion? We did that?
Beyond Oasis? Really?
Shit, I don't know.
These two games feature the same three characters. What game has three characters? The first one was an arcade game, and the second one was only for
It's got to be a fighter, right?
With three characters in it?
Mm. G. All right. G. G-A. Game Masters.
Game.
Game of three characters. Genesis game.
I see what you did. Just moved on to the next vowel. I get it.
Gin and tonic. Genesis. I don't know. I have no clue.
All right. We're going to take a mulligan on that. It is Golden Axe and Golden Axe 2.
Oh.
I feel like we should have got that.
We did those games.
Yeah, we did do those games. Remember where I was like, yeah, we did those? We did those.
I feel like that was where we accidentally played. Like, I accidentally played 2 and you played 1 or vice versa or something like that.
We'll have to ask
the
archivist.
They're very similar. I don't know. Yeah.
That was episode 386 for those playing at home.
I hadn't gotten to the O's yet. A-E-I-O, that was next.
God game?
God in it?
Next question. This arcade game had the subtitle, Demons of Death. Demons of Death! It's Galaga for the NES.
Oh, nice. You're much better at these G's than I am. They're just not in my memory banks.
Just because it has the most obscene subtitle of any game.
Mm-hmm.
What episode number do you think that was?
399.
Like, really? How did Nintendo let them do that?
Yeah.
430, Galaga.
430.
Next question. This game is called Super Royal Blood in Japan and sounds like it should be an RPG, but is actually a tedious turn-based strategy game. This game was called Super Royal Blood. Gemfire.
Nice.
It was the Royal Blood.
Mm-hmm.
It was the Royal. It has to be Gemfire, right?
You're right. It has to be Gemfire.
What episode number do you think? That was recent. We recorded that in the
505.
Is that a Levi's thing?
Yeah.
is that a button fly?
100%.
Is that a button fly game?
my flared.
I'm a big fan of a button fly.
Yeah.
I do like the button fly.
I don't know what that is.
Oh, it's like instead of a zipper, it's just buttons.
Oh.
So okay. When you're about to get a blowjob, you get to pretend to be like a Civil War general. And be like, locking it in, 505, gym fire. It is gym fire, 512.
Nice.
Next question. Last question. Mm. This game almost cost a sandwich pope his marriage.
Ghoul Patrol.
Yeah. Excellent.
I got one.
I was sitting here like, Dungeon Master? I guess it has a G in it. What episode number do you think that was? That was very recent.
531?
That's this episode. No, just kidding.
I think this, like, we're all like 536 or 537 or something.
Look, I don't know. I just work here. locking it in.
531.
531. Ghoul Patrol. It is 536. Ghoul Patrol.
All right.
Well done, Tyler.
Well done, Dave. You were the one who did all the heavy lifting on that one.
Well, we can share the failure that is Golden Axe and Golden Axe 2.
Yeah.
Thank you for the quiz, Ross. I love your quizzes.
Yes, thank you, Prime Inquisitor.
Want to take some calls?
Let's take some fucking calls. Take some calls.
Well, I get that set up. How can people reach us if they want to talk to us on the phone?
Well, we have a Google Voice line set up. You can call. It just kind of beeps now. It used to say fucking TADPOG, but just call it. It's 270-883-2555. We've got quite the extensive backlog, almost a year, but we'll get to that. We promise. Eventually.
God, that felt so good.
Yeah, did you like that?
Let's do it again. I can do multiples.
Okay, Melissa.
All right, first call. It's from 757. We all know who that is.
You bet we do.
It's our beloved Adam.
What up, TADPOG? It's your beloved Adam. Spring has sprung and pollen is everywhere. It's out to get us.
Plant cum.
Telling you, man. Stuff is treacherous business. Listening to the episode, World of Illusion episode, and your guest, whose name escapes me right now, that has a new website name that is, I agree that I thought it would have been taken by now, and you guys are playing through World of Illusion together, but at the beginning he was talking about his game collection. He's got about 500 NES games, which I love here, and I love to hear that he has Panic Restaurant because that one is super fun, even though it's really expensive. But he was talking about tournament fighters, and I have a couple questions about this. So he said that the game fluctuates between $400 and $800, and he bought it for about $40.
Does he know he can get Pac-Man 2 for like $2?
Why are you even buying other games? Quit wasting your money.
From his game store. So that leads me to think two things. One, when he bought it from his game store, it was a new copy. I mean, not new, sorry, loose copy. Because right now that game loose goes for about $120, anywhere in that range. So I'm guessing when he bought it from that game store, maybe it was at $80, and he got 50% off, and that's what was $40. Because he never said that it was complete in the box. If he had it complete in the box, then yes, it's definitely $400 to $500 game. So I just want to find out, like, does my man have the game box and manual? Because if so, props, man. Because personally, I love Tournament Fighters on the NES. It's not as good as the Super Nintendo port, but find for me a better 1v1 two-button fighting game on the Nintendo, and I'll buy you a steak dinner. I mean,
challenge accepted.
Very well. I will dine on your steak, well, beloved Adam.
My quest begins immediately.
Game is amazing for a two-button fighter. And I love this guy because one of his favorite games is Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles 2 on the NES, which I had as well, and I love it as a kid. And in the manual, there is a coupon for a personal fan pizza.
Yep.
You can't get any better than that. So we're not even talking about Ninja Turtles in this episode.
Guess what page was never in the instruction manual at my local video store? I always wondered about that as a kid. I was like, did the owner take that? Or was it just the first kid who rented it? Was like, fuck yes!
We just earned our money back, Mom.
And then the kid's mom was like, we're going to all the video stores.
We're going to rent all of them, then we're all going to feast on personal pan pizzas.
So, and I'm excited about it already, so I'm going to get back into it. But I just wanted to call and find out if my man has the game complete or just lose, because either way it excites me, but I just kind of wanted to know for my own joy. All right, guys. It was good to talk to you, and hopefully I will call back soon. I love you. Bye.
We love you too, beloved Adam.
We love you too.
Tournament Fighters is a great game.
Mm-hmm.
I like Tournament Fighters.
Yep.
And there is, I discovered this recently because I truly didn't believe it for a moment, but of course it's a thing. People still play that game.
Yeah.
Competitively.
Yeah.
And I
like that all the turtles are very different. That is very, very cool.
Yeah.
That's one thing that, like, the one on NES doesn't do as effectively as they should.
And
you know, any turtles game, all four turtles should function very differently.
I agree. I the other day I was bored and it was like, let me see how many of the Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtle games I've played. So I just looked, I was like, you know, list of Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtle games. I ran across a game that I played a lot as a kid and then completely forgot about. And it was just like, I saw it on the list and I was like, like Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles. I think it was called Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles 3, The Manhattan Missions. And it was like a DOS game. Like
it wasn't the Manhattan Project we did.
Right. It was a DOS game, and I'm sure they were like, oh, the Manhattan Project, let's name it after that, kind of, sort of. But it was straight up, like, made for DOS, and I remember playing it and loving it. And then I like, looked up the box art. I'm like, oh, my God. Like, this was one of those where it's like, this one didn't come from dad's work, you know? This is one that was purchased at like at a Babbage's or something.
Was it in the discount bin at Piggly Wiggly where they just threw the dollar discs?
This was a big deal game. Mm-hmm. Like this, there's a box and a manual, paper. Like most of the games came home on a floppy disc with Sharpie on it, right? I'm sure the statutes of limitation.
Here, go downstairs while I fuck your mom. Here's something. Bye.
No. I know when he fucked my mom.
He made sure I knew.
I don't know if he made sure I knew, but I definitely knew. Because I'd be reading in my room and then be like, oh, again. Go easy, Dad.
She's a small woman.
But, man, and then what's fucked up about it
is... We got to make it good, kid. Shut up.
They did. They succeeded. They did make a good one. Once I was reminded of this game, I then forgot about it again until right now. Beloved Adam called and mentioned it. I was even thinking, like, this happens to me all the time. Like, I get, like, real excited to do a thing, and then, like, I just forget about it. Something happens, and I just forget about it because it's like, oh, right, real shit that I have to do.
Oh, man, this sounds fun. Mate, what the hell am I? Okay, never mind.
Am I allowed to do it? No, I'm not. I'm not allowed to do that.
Deleted.
Yeah, memory gone. Gonna go pull that memory down into the recycling bin?
Not enough disk space. Okay. Yeah.
You know how, like, when Sherlock Holmes talks about, like, he doesn't bother himself with details that don't matter because it just fills up his hard drive space, essentially, with details. I'm the opposite of that. I'm just full of details that don't fucking matter, and then I have to constantly delete them to fill it up with more shit that does not matter.
Oh, man, the Manhattan missions. Oh, yeah, but Chuck Lorre wrote the theme song to Teenage Ninja Turtles. I know that.
And unfortunately, the hard drive space that is my mind is 75% full of pornography.
But you put GAC in the container, it'll fart.
Oh, that's a thing that you don't even learn or forget.
That's nature.
That's nature.
You come born with that.
Yeah. You remember Floam?
Oh, fuck yeah, I remember Floam.
Were you a big Floam guy?
Yeah.
I never had Floam.
Oh, I had a lot of Floam. It was fun, but also fucking dried out, like, immediately.
GAC was kind of the same way, because I remember, like, if you left the lid off a GAC for, like, an hour,
mm-hmm.
if you weren't actively GACing it, then it got pretty dry.
Because I remember GAC, I discovered GAC the same day I discovered Bagel Bites at a Sam's Club in Chicago, like, the year it came out.
Wait, back that up.
Uh-huh.
In Chicago?
In Chicago. My parents had randomly, we were in Chicago. I don't know why. We stopped at a giant, I assume it was Sam's, like a giant warehouse type store. I remember just being like, holy shit. And they had this one vendor who's giving out these little thing, little pizza things.
Oh,
like,
free samples.
Oh, and yeah. I ate so many. I was like, that's the best food I've ever had in my life. My parents bought all sorts of it in a giant cooler and brought it back with us.
Mom, you can have pizza anytime. What pizza's on a bagel?
I remember I was, I want to think I was with Brandon's parents or something. Like, I remember just driving back, like, eating bagel bites and playing with Gak that they also had there. And I was like, man, life does not get any fucking better than this. I don't even have any video games, but man, as long as I have these bagel bites with this Gak, man, I'm good.
And the Al Capone Museum. What a day. What's your favorite Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles movie? Not movie, game. And movie, fuck it. I've never seen the third movie where they go back in time.
You've never seen it?
Never seen it.
I mean, two is still my favorite.
Two's your favorite?
Yeah. I would say, I think one is the better movie, but two is my favorite.
Okay, yeah.
Purely nostalgia reasons.
Right. No, I get that. Even like that scene, the fight scene in, like, in the mall, like the opening fight scene, mm-hmm. You know? I like that one.
Although I am burnt out on it now, probably Turtles in Time.
I'm also burnt out on Turtles in Time. Yeah. Like, I played that too many times.
Too many times at Gang Galaxy. Yeah.
Yeah. All right, we have another call. Oh, speaking of Turtles and Gak and things that dried up, I used to slime the Turtles with ooze.
That's pretty good.
And that stuff would totally, like,
get in their joints and ruin them.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Yeah, I know that feel.
Yeah. Yeah. All right. Next call coming in from beloved Adam again.
What's up, TADPOG? It's your beloved Adam again. His name is Stephen Michael.
Stephen Michael.
We knew that. We just knew you were going to get there.
Yeah.
We want to give you the opportunity.
We'll give him a little lead enough time. He'll find his way home.
Yeah.
Website is Retro Gaming Monthly. I know these things because I listen and I care, but I was really nervous calling you guys, and you probably could tell. I was really nervous trying to get my details out there and get my call in. And
sounded great.
It sounded like it was my first time ever calling into the show.
You're like Madonna. You're like a virgin. Every time you call TADPOG, it's like your first time.
The very first time.
That's how we know that you love us so much. Thank you for giving us.
You regrow your call hymen every time. We appreciate that.
Thank you for giving us your voicemail flower.
It's been a while since I called. Because
been a while.
A few people, even some former guest hosts, don't like when I call as much as I do. So I just decided, you know what? I'm going to fly under the radar for a little while, and I'll just call sporadically when things pop up so that people don't get annoyed at all calls or annoyed that I call too much.
Nah, dude.
No, we love you, Adam.
Super glad that you're back. Although I will say that I am glad that we don't do all calls episodes anymore. I think that they're fun. Like, I think the conversations are fun, but I don't know, man. It never failed. We would do an all calls episode and there would be some degree of drama.
Yep, you're right. Every time.
And this is what happens. When I don't get the call all the time, my calls end up feeling like a 13-year-old boy rubbing one out in his crotch for the first time before his parents get home from dinner. I get all spazzy and nervous and stumble and stammer. And
fuck them. They went out to dinner without you. Come in their socks.
Or did you say, like, no, I'm fine here. I like peanut butter sandwiches. You go to dinner.
I've done that a few times. I remember doing that.
I did.
Just not a good look. So I think I gave it a shot, and I'm not cut out for that mess. So I'm just gonna keep calling a lot, and I'm just not sorry for being not sorry. So I'll call more often, and that way my calls can go back to a smooth, silky cadence and be a good time for you guys.
Yeah, man.
So,
keep it at a six.
I don't have any
or even a seven, maybe.
I wish I had a question that I could ask, but here we go. You guys an innie or an outie? Mine kind of goes in and out, so I consider myself an innie outie, but
it goes in and out?
That's not possible, Adam.
So what you're saying is, my name is Adam and I have an outie. And I'm weird about it.
My name is Adam XY. I don't even have a belly button.
Yeah, how is it both? Call back, please, unless you're about to explain it in the next 10 seconds.
I can send you guys a picture of it if you need to see it.
Yep.
Tell me, what are you guys? Any or Addy? All right. Love you guys. Bye.
like, I bringing it back to bagel bites, is it like a bagel bite where sometimes all the toppings are like on one side?
Do you have pepperonis mush out of it? Did you put it in the microwave and the cheese just sort of sloughs off the side?
I'm guessing yes.
Yeah. I am a very deep innie that I can put the entire first segment of my pinky into it.
Up to the first knuckle?
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm also an innie, and I can't get it in that far.
Mm-hmm.
I bottom out about halfway to my first knuckle.
I have a lot more gut than you do, so this lines up.
So
I have a half a pinky more gut than you do.
Retro Gaming Monthly, yes. Stephen Michael, he still runs Retro Gaming Monthly, and I know that this month we're playing Crystallis. What I've done is decided that if it's a Super Nintendo game that we're playing that month, then I'll play it. I'm on this Super Nintendo kick. Although Crystallis is one of those games where it's like I've heard wonderful things about it, and I really should give it a go. But if anybody out there is listening and you want to play a game each month with a group of cool people, look up Retro Gaming Monthly, the Facebook group on the Face-Face.
On the Face-Face.
On the Face-Face. But yeah, beloved Adam, you're definitely going to need to send us a photo.
All right, well, I'm of the opinion I need to buy this belly button that he called about a year ago, and let's make all his nightmares come true and call Adam and ask him.
I don't think he would like that.
I love Adam, though.
Well,
he needs to know.
I love him, too, but he, in the past, has said that he's always terrified that when he calls, someone's going to pick up.
We'll call him from the Tadpog line, because I'm sure we've got to be in his phone as much as he calls.
We're definitely in his contacts,
so
for sure.
We'll call, then he has the option whether he wants to pick up or not.
All right. So what are we going to say? Tell us about your belly button.
Just like, hey, Adam, it's your beloved Tadpog. Calling to hear about that any Audi contradictory existence belly button.
Let's make his, if he decides to pick up, let's make it a real nightmare. And ask him about last episode. Let's just see if he's listened.
All right.
What do you think of time tracks? Hey, we're calling random listeners. We need feedback. What'd you think of the intro story on time? What'd you think of the stinger on time tracks?
Perfect. Perfect.
I don't even remember what the stinger was on time tracks.
Let's make people not want to listen to us. Let's call him.
We don't have to try to do that. Let's
face it. It's happening on its own.
All right. Yeah, let's give him a call. I love it. What do you think? Do you think he's going to pick up?
No.
You don't think he's going to pick up?
I don't think he's going to pick up.
Really?
I think he's going to panic and not pick up.
Really?
In the middle, he tells him, if they call back again, I'll pick up. And then we shouldn't call back again.
All right, I'm calling. One ring. Two rings. If voicemail picks up, I'm hanging up. I don't want to dox beloved Adam.
This is the day I've been waiting for my whole freaking life.
Beloved Adam.
It warms my heart. It warms my heart.
Oh,
that
my
is how
God,
you answered the phone.
Right now.
Ah, beloved Adam. We were worried that you weren't going to pick up. We were really worried that you were going to be upset that we called you.
But we were right that we're in your contacts.
What's up, man?
No. I knew. I was just eating waffles.
Tonight's the night.
Every night after I get home, I sit at my table and I eat waffles and I look at my phone and I just wait. One day they're going to call me.
Today's the day.
Today's that day.
Because what we do, we just sit there like, oh, who's fucking calling me this late? What?
No, this is perfect. This is perfect.
What do you like? What do you like with your waffles? Just butter and syrup or what?
I don't do butter, but I do syrup, but I put peanut butter in it.
Okay.
Oh, you're like my kids. You make that awful concoction of smelly, sticky.
All right. What I hear is that I can start calling you daddy now.
What do you mean? What do you mean start?
Well, I mean to you. I mean, when I talk to you, you know, to other people.
So you tell your wife, I was listening to my daddy's last night.
Oh, yeah.
So we're just doing some we're calling some listeners and asking them how they felt about the stinger and time tracks.
Oh, I haven't got it yet. I just downloaded it today.
I knew you weren't listening anymore.
I was I was a little sad because I realized when I downloaded it today, I was like, oh, shoot, I'm all caught up. And because lately I've just been like ripping through episodes while I'm working my day job. And then I got to it today and I'm like, oh, no, I only have one episode that's new. Not to mention all the Patreon episodes that I've never listened to yet. So,
well, that's what you got to do. You got almost a whole campaign of Call of Cthulhu to listen to.
The Piggy Palace stuff is really good.
Yeah, I'm waiting till it's all out so I can have a listening party with myself.
Nice. Okay.
All right.
Tyler's assured me that we're all going to die next session, so you'll probably be able to listen real soon.
Yeah.
Okay, perfect. Perfect. It gives me just enough time to go buy some new lotion.
So your belly button that is simultaneously an innie and an outie.
Right. We need to know about that.
Yeah, mine is.
But how? Like, is it out on one side and in on the other side?
No. It's kind of like if you it kind of goes. So let me explain this. It goes down like off the edge of the belly, and then it kind of puckers out like a little like a nipple. I don't know how to explain it.
So
you're a monster is what you're telling us.
Where's
Let me look at it. Let me look at it while I describe it.
Please.
So it goes in like a normal belly button would go in, but like the little tip of the umbilical cord that got cut off is still like just kind of there.
Okay.
I'm doing a terrible job.
So it just peaks out like a mountain, like a volcano coming out of the ocean.
If you had somebody that had like a real shallow innie and you put a pencil eraser in their belly button, that's what mine looks like.
Okay.
When you were a baby, did you have like the belly button that was like swollen on the end, like it came out of your belly button?
You know, it's been a long time since I was a baby, so I'm not 100% positive.
Well, that's what Jack had. So if you were one of those kids, then I totally get it.
Okay. I'll just send you a picture of my belly button on Instagram, and that way you can see it.
May we post it publicly on tadpog.com?
Yeah, I mean, I'm not worried about it.
That'd be the new episode art.
They hate me. That's not going to change anything about it if they see my belly button, you know?
the episode art for this episode is going to be, you'll get this when you listen to the episode, a kid eating a giant hamburger and then beloved Adam's belly button.
Yes. This is, again, what I've been waiting for my whole life.
You're also probably obvious, but we should tell you that you are on the podcast. This isn't just we're
just calling you. We're live on the show right now.
Oh my gosh, I'm coming right now.
Yeah, we were just bored hanging out. Right, let's call Adam. It's like, no, we're recording. We're done. It's like, okay, well, we just took calls from Adam. Let's call him
right before we make out, because we do
right
that
before we kiss the show.
Yeah.
Oh man, yeah.
I hope Adam. Yeah. I hope that your wife walks in right now and she's like, "Why are you eating waffles, looking at your belly button, talking on the phone, and coming at the same time?"
Yeah, yes. And I'd be like, "Stop it! I'm talking to my daddy." You'll never understand this love. She's like, "I'm 36 weeks pregnant with your baby. What do you mean I won't understand?" Like, you heard me, woman. I think you won't understand.
Hey, we're about that far behind in calls, so congratulations.
Yeah, congratulations.
Yes, thank you. Let me tell you this. I'll tell you this up front. I called and told you guys first.
Oh, shit.
So after my wife found out, she told me, and then I was like, I got to get in the car. I got to go somewhere. Like, I'm so, like, I called you guys.
I'm calling my daddies.
On the voicemail.
I love it, man. That's awesome.
I gotta call my daddies. They're going to be so proud.
I hope it was an existential breakdown where you were calling us for advice. Like, fuck, man, I don't know what to fucking do. I don't have enough money for a fucking kid. Shit, tap on.
Yes. No, I called you guys right away. I had to share the news.
That's awesome, man.
Awesome.
Yeah. So her due date is on February 29th on leap year.
Oh, that's
wow.
That's fucking awesome.
Yeah, that is really cool.
Yeah, a kid like Roy from Wings only have a birthday every 4 years.
I will. Yeah, I know, right? She won't drive until I'm long gone.
So you know it's a girl.
Yes.
Can we get a name, or is that secret?
Are you thinking about names?
Yeah, I'll tell you the name. I'll tell you the name that I haven't told our entire church right now.
Wait. Are you naming her Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles Fighters Edition?
All right, who told?
TMNTina. Perfect.
TM and Tina.
TM and Tina. Nice.
And I know it's tournament fighters. Thanks for being polite.
Yes. Yeah. Actually, I'm going to name her Kirby's Dream Course.
Oh, so we'll hate her. Okay.
Only the best game ever made.
Oh, listen, I'm not going to lie to you guys. I love that game so very much. I really, really love it.
You and everybody I talk to on Twitch, like I owe that game a revisit.
Well, I'll tell you this right now. If you and Tyler play it together, it's a totally different game. It's better than playing it by yourself.
Okay.
When you play it together, it's so much more fun.
All right.
I can promise you that.
Okay. I can see that.
But you do have to give it some time. It takes a little while.
And get Baja Blasted. That probably helps too.
Yeah. I mean, if that's your bag, get after it.
All right. I'm in.
Yeah. Yes.
But so, you're going to prom right after the birth of your daughter, right?
Yes, we're skipping.
Perfect.
You got to come out to prom, man, some year.
I would love to. I would love to. That would be a blast. It would. I'll have to plan it. I'll have to plan for it. I got to tell you the name, though.
Please.
I
got
to share the name with somebody. So we're going to name her Luna Wren, W-R-E-N.
I like
that's
that.
That's awesome. Yeah.
Some Fancy Star 4 in there. So, perfect.
Yeah, so Wren is a building at a university nearby here, William and Mary. It's a chapel, and that's where my wife and I got married. We got married at Wren Chapel. So in my mind, the two of the three best days of my life involved that building, when I married my wife and when our baby is born. So I had to sneak that name in there.
And this is the third, I'm assuming?
This is the third day?
I consider my life with TADPOG as one day. So
okay.
I was thinking the first time I ever called TADPOG, but that was this day definitely rivals that day. Yeah. That's full circle right there. That's full circle.
Well, I don't want it to be full circle because I definitely want you to still listen.
I'm done. I guess
I'm never stopping. No way. No. Well, I called a couple times yesterday. I took a break from calling people because I thought, you know, people probably want a little bit of a break. And then terrified Michelle was like, yo, hold my beer.
She took up the mantle. You're like Bruce Wayne who died. And she's like, I'll be Batman.
Yep, that's it. That's it. And now I'm just going to Bucky Barnes myself back into this thing. And I'm like, hey, guys,
perfect.
I'm back.
Perfect. I'm here. Please, please do. We love your calls, man.
So, Adam, since we're calling you, hey,
man.
We love you.
We love you, beloved Adam.
Hey, man, this is the best day. I wish I had a podcast where I could have recorded this.
Well, we recorded it for you. You could have it.
Yeah, you can hear it the day after tomorrow.
I love it. I'm going to play it as soon as my baby comes out of the vagina.
Sweet.
I'm like, listen to your daddy talk to his daddy.
We might get a doctor to start listening. That'd be cool. Well, we got Dr.
Dude, I'll work on it. Yeah. There you go.
Is Dr. Drunk delivering your baby?
If only.
TADPOG Village. We need to make it happen.
Mm-hmm.
Yes. Send him my way. I'll gladly let him look at my wife's body.
You hear that, Dr. Drunk?
Oh, shit.
Hey, listen, man. You can see both the women in my life naked at the same time. Shoot, I'll get naked for you, too. We'll all
stand out here. The nurse is like, what is happening?
I want her to see where she came from. So
it's fair. That's fair.
Oh shit! So you're like, I think you're like an hour ahead of us, right? Are you like, is it like almost 11 there?
Yeah. Yep.
I was worried because I thought I remember previous calls. You're like, all right, I'm calling you guys at 5 a.m. So I was like, we might wake up an angry Adam. But I'm glad you are awake eating waffles.
No way. I could never be angry. Never be angry.
Okay. Well, we just wanted to call real quick, tell you we love you.
Oh, man.
Have some
Thank
stories.
You so much.
So.
Day made. This could potentially be the very best day of February, and I've got a daughter on the way.
She might make it to March, right?
Yeah. And if she doesn't, well, you know, she'll understand.
Well, thanks for picking up, Adam. We appreciate it.
Yeah, dude. It was nice talking to you.
Yes. Thank you for calling. I knew this was going to happen one day. I had to do it. I just knew it. I should have screenshotted it. I should have screenshotted this right now.
You want us to call you back? You screenshot it.
Did you just hang up trying to screenshot it?
Oh, maybe.
I think he did.
You want to call him back?
Yeah, he's okay.
All right.
No, but thank you very much, Adam. That was great.
That was great.
That made our day too.
Yeah, for real, man. We should have opened the podcast like that. Can you imagine how the rest of it would have been?
Let's call someone we think likes us to get us in a good mood. Oh, there he is.
Call from
beloved Adam.
To accept, press 1.
We've never done this before.
Is this a collect call?
To accept.
Beloved Adam?
Oh, my gosh. I knew this was going to happen one day, too. I knew you were going to pick up.
Well, I mean, the last call ended so strangely that I felt like we needed to.
Well, I was trying to screenshot my phone, and it hung up.
Tyler called it.
I was like, this is the absolute worst day of my whole life. I'm a roller coaster of emotion. Right now.
All right, man.
Oh, I guess you can't screenshot. Oh, well.
Well, I mean, you can always listen to this whenever you want. Yeah. I know that we will. Thanks for giving us some verification.
Oh, yes. Yes. Anytime. Anytime at all. Day or night. It's always on.
We'll probably call you back sometime then.
Yep.
Do what now?
We'll probably call you back sometime then.
Okay.
If the door's just wide open.
Yeah. Yep. I'll do my best.
Awesome, man. Good talking to you.
All right. All right. You too, guys. Man, hey, I really do mean it. I love you guys.
Oh, we love you too.
Doing what you do. Thanks for doing what you do relentlessly. Thank you for letting us see into your lives, your families, be a part of your family, be your friends, hear your ups, hear your downs, all of it, man. Thank you so much. It's been a life-giving thing for me in the last couple of years just to be a part of this. So, man, thank you so much for all you do. I mean it.
Well, thanks. Well,
thank you.
Yeah, that's really nice to hear. I mean, thanks for supporting us. I mean, thanks for, believing in us and helping us succeed.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah, man. Yeah. All right, guys. I love you so much. I'll call you soon.
All right. Love you.
Love you too, Adam.
Have a good come.
All right.
Bye.
All right, bye.
All right.
Very good.
Yeah.
Let's close it on that.
Yes.
Wrap that up.
Well, there is one thing we have to do.
Oh, okay, yeah, okay. Let me pull up my... Hopefully Adam has blessed us. Luck of the Adam. Let's see.
Will this be the litmus test on whether or not we call
Will
Adam
Will we ever
back?
Call Adam again? I'm going to unlock this cage over here, this display box where I have this...
I was about to say, it's been downgraded to a cage.
After Pac-Man 2, it's in a cage.
Get in a cage!
I'm going to pull up this Louisville Slugger signed by one Donnie Jeffcoat. Place it on the one end on the ground, one end on my forehead so I could turn in a circle. So my no-no holds pointed in a random direction.
Please, that's important.
And say the prayer we all love to say.
Is your no-no hole an innie or an outie?
It's both.
Are you purple socking?
I have the Kyle XY Adam belly button of assholes. No whammies, no whammies, no whammies. Stop.
97.
Ooh, shit.
Castlevania, Dracula X. Would you like to see if there's a randomizer version of it?
Well, there probably is, but we'll do that especially a special episode.
I'll bet you money that there's not.
You don't think so?
I don't know. I mean, maybe.
That might be harder to randomize than like an RPG.
I mean, how do you randomize it? You just fight a different monster?
Different monsters all over the place? All right. Let's do this again.
All right.
Burp, burp. No whammies, no whammies, no whammies. Stop.
542. 542.
The F's? That's way down there.
Yeah. Want to take another guess?
H?
The S's.
Ooh.
Could be anything.
S's. Ugh.
First word, street.
Street Fighter 2 Turbo Edition?
Close. Street Hockey 95.
God, fuck. Okay.
By GTE Entertainment. Ever heard of them?
Fuck you, Adam. You did this. You did this. You ruined us.
So we're going from Pac-Man 2 to Street Hockey 95.
God.
We'll find out which is the better game.
Yeah. Can we do knuckle pucks? We'll see.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Street Hockey.
Street Hockey.
So thanks for listening, everybody. You can find the show on tadpog.com, on iTunes, on Stitcher, YouTube, and Spotify.
Mm-hmm.
Let's see what else. Hey, you want to call us? And eventually, maybe we'll call you back at a very horrible time for you.
If you earn it.
If you earn it. That's 270-883-2555. Do you want to send us, like, the awesome Bunny and Kira did with these mugs and coffee? You can send that to TADPOG Studios, care of Nicole Nance, P.O. Box 3785, Paducah, Kentucky, 42002. Let's see. Hey, all right. So you like you like memes? Facebook.com/TADPOG. It's our episode posts, memes.
Dude, can we change can we change the name of our page to Meme Girls?
Oh, fuck. All right, let's change the whole podcast to Meme Girls.
Awesome.
That's really good.
Awesome.
And Lindsay Lohan with both of our faces put on her. Perfect.
Or the other way around. Oh, just our bodies with Lindsay Lohan's face on it.
No difference can be told.
It's like the Parent Trap. We'll just replicate the Parent Trap poster.
Let's see. But hey, you want that deep TADPOG shit, that dank TADPOG shit?
I do.
Stuff you don't want your grandma to see?
As deep as it'll go, please.
As deep as it'll go.
Please put it in deep.
Cervix smashing.
Very deep.
TADPOG business. TADPOG Nation. But are you a good boy? Are you a good boy? You want to talk about the Piggy Palace?
I am a good boy.
Various other games you can do on our Discord.
Mm-hmm. bit.ly/TADPOG Discord will get you an invite there. We're playing through Secret of Mana on the Discord server. We're not playing it on the Discord server's not a Super Nintendo. I want to dismiss any myths that might be out there. But we're talking about our experiences playing Secret of Mana on there.
Well, our shirts, our experience are going out of business sale. So if you want to get on that before they're gone sometime, that's shirts.tadpog.com.
Mm-hmm.
Our Instagram and our Twitter, tadpog_podcast.
Mm-hmm.
Most importantly, we got that Patreon.
We do. We do have a Patreon. Patreon.com/tadpog, I think.
Yeah, that's it. Let me see. You mean to do that? You mean to pull that up?
Yeah, I think this is just your job now.
Okay.
Are you good with that?
That's fine.
All right. We're doing restructuring here at TADPOG. And that restructuring is called Dave is scared he's going to forget somebody.
I don't give a fuck. All right. So we've got some new pledges. All right. So thank you very much to Shane Johnson. Thank you very much. And to John Konopasek. Konopasek? Let us know, John. I don't want to say that wrong. Let me know. You're giving us some money.
Yeah.
The least I can do is pronounce your name right. So thank you very much.
I stream on Twitch on Sunday nights, TADPOG Church. If you want to come hang out, it's usually about 8:30 Central Time. And I've been trying to stream more. I've been trying to, like, when I feel like it.
Yeah, man.
I just want to, it's fun.
It's good. I like the impromptu when I get a Twitter alert, like, hey, TADPOG Podcast is going live on Twitch.
I'm glad. Hell yeah. I'm glad that you like it. And I love that you are in chat.
Yeah.
That always makes me feel good.
Always.
So thanks for being there.
Are we executive produced by anybody?
We are. We are executive produced by the following people who are very generous in their donations on Patreon. This episode has been executive produced by Usurper Grimm, 1383, God Emperor Alex Pena, Cousin David Galino, Laud Mulaney Dennis, Platinum Member Brett Miller, The Eightfold Daniel Abernathy, Master Cycle Baron Kevin Link, and executive producer Dig Dougie.
Hell yeah. Our theme song of Moves, Let's Get More Drive, link to that track, from the shows at tadpog.com. I would like to close this out, Dave.
Like the Ghost Witch.
Okay.
Who definitely looks like Rita Repulsa's sister. Half-sister.
Perfect.
It's like if Rita Repulsa's mom...
Her American half-sister.
It's like if her mom fucked a ghost.
Man, hell yeah.
Her mom was Demi Moore. I don't know if you knew that.
The baby that was made when they fucked in the movie Ghost, yeah. Evil Witch from Pac-Man.
But Ghost Witch is actually more like the pot.
That's her phylactery.
That's how she makes ghosts.
So until next time.
Tropical Capricorn.
Give me your chewed gum.
5th achievement comes in from Big Dick Pie Baker Chris Vaughn. Gone Postal. In order to unlock Gone Postal, shoot everyone you see on sight. Next achievement comes in from Dan. Rude Awakening. In order to unlock Rude Awakening, shoot Pac-Man in the balls to wake him up. I've already done that. It's okay. That's fine. Fuck it. We'll do it live. Next achievement I got comes in from Cthusiast Jeff. I don't need this shit. In order to unlock I don't need this shit, piss off Pac-Man until he gets pissed and refuses to listen to you.
That's good.
Next achievement comes in from Josh ATC. Step back from that ledge, my friend. In order to unlock step back from that ledge, my friend, help cheer Pac-Man up after he falls into a crippling depression, which you can easily do with a balloon. If only more therapists knew about balloons.
That's true.
Next achievement comes in from Cthusiast Jeff, Superman. In order to unlock Superman, successfully pass the hang glider level under 30 attempts. It's impossible. It's impossible. Next achievement comes in from Big Dick Pie Baker Chris Vaughn. Eat shit, Pac-Man. In order to unlock eat shit, Pac-Man, make Pac-Man get on the skateboard going the wrong direction. Next achievement comes in from Zal. The real game. We did this all on the show, but that's okay. The real game. Find the game within the game and play that instead, because it's good, and Pac-Man 2 is not.
Yup.
Also, the original Pac-Man 2 is Miss Pac-Man. Next achievement comes in from P. Willie Eaton. Tony Pack's semi-pro skater. And in order to unlock Tony Pack's semi-pro skater, pull off the elusive combo 50-50 grind to hitting a rock to smashing a tree to the pack morgue. Also, I want to give a shout-out. I know it's a shitty shout-out in the stinger, but I want to give a shout-out to Willie because he's just started streaming recently. He streams under the name Ice Brand Studios. So nice. So look him up. I know he streamed some Secret of Mana the other night. Next achievement comes in from Edgelord Kyle. Secret of Pac-Mana. And in order to unlock Secret of Pac-Mana, secretly fall into a domesticated depression because you're stuck playing Pac-Man 2 instead of Secret of Mana. Next achievement comes in from Nate from Utah, first time caller, and Billy Mitchell. Hackman. In order to unlock Hackman, lie about getting the Pac-Man's kill screen. That's the one that I was thinking of when he said Pacception. Next achievement comes in from the Otter's Couch, a.k.a. Mr. 69 on Twitch. Nice. Check out the Otter's Couch. Pack-on-pack violence. And in order to unlock pack-on-pack violence, when Pac-Man goes home at night and tells the tale of what happened to his wife then doesn't believe him and has some domestic violence, and the pack police are called. Next achievement comes in from Mr. 69, a.k.a. the Otter's Couch, Chris Hansen. In order to unlock Chris Hansen, when you realize Pac-Man is a child or toddler and further realize he has had children with his wife, making his wife a monster and a pedophile. Next achievement comes in from Nathan Eaton. Henry 2. I get it, because Pac-Man. Pac-Man. Henry 2. In order to unlock Henry 2, realize that Pac-Man 2 is basically a toddler father simulator.
Oh, okay. I want you to start shooting Henry with a slingshot every time he...
What do you mean start? Next achievement comes in from Edgelord Kyle, Ghost Train. In order to unlock Ghost Train, eat out all four of the ghosts while tripping on your power pellet and call none of them the day after. Thanks for the achievements, y'all.